What was your I was only gone X minutes, what the heck happened story? I was watching TV and went to my room to get my phone charger. I was gone maximum 2 minutes. When I got back, a goat was on the coffee table. It scared the crap out of me. Where do you live where goats just appear on coffee tables? A little over a year ago, my now husband and I were prepping for a move and needed to take a handful of garbage bags to the dumpster in our apartment community. We patted each of our dogs, a 7-year-old mini schnauzer and a 16-year-old rat terrier, two small dogs. This is very important later on the head, and headed out. Less than 5 minutes later, we come back, both of the dogs meeting us at the door with wagging tails and big smiles. All seems perfect until we round the corner into the dining room. One of the dogs shat clear up two walls, about 4.5 feet up across about 6 feet wide worth of wall. I was laughing too hard to clean it up. The husband saved the day and cleaned it up. But with such force and distance, we can only imagine the absolutely gut-wrenching noise that dog, still not sure which one, had to have made when it did its big business. We were seriously only gone 5 minutes. We now refer to it as the pooping of 2015. The best part of this is the inclusion of the year, as if you need to distinguish it from previous poopings. Left the mail room to go get my wipes to clean off the scanner glass. Was gone 3 minutes. Came back to find the entire mail room coated in toner, and a toner-covered co-worker just standing there looking confused and alarmed. Never even asked, just went to get our boss to go deal with it. This visual is amazing. The co-worker standing there in shock. My dog followed me to the door and then I shut it. Was in there for about 45 seconds. Then opened the door to find puddles of dog diarrhea all over the living room. Haha, same with me. My Great Dane was house trained and never messed up at all. Walked out to the garage to get a screwdriver, came into huge puddles of dog crap. He was trying to hide under the bed. Fell asleep on the couch for like 10 minutes, I swear. Woke up to mayhem. Two toddlers had scribbled all over the walls. The younger one had begun scribbling with crayon, and the older one, 3, became upset he was breaking the rules. So she grabbed a pencil and began marking gigantic X's as large as she could make. You cannot draw here or here or here. I woke up to the entire first floor covered in pencil X's and crayon scribbles everywhere. Comma fell asleep. Comma two toddlers. Choose one. Not gone per se, but asleep. I was flying lax SFO. My flight was delayed about 5 hours, so I did what any sensible frequent traveler does. I went to the club lounge and drank as much free bourbon as they would allow. We finally boarded the plane. I was in one of the first groups because, again, I fly a lot. So, by the time we take off, I'm fast asleep. The captain comes on the intercom and says, "Don't panic, seatbelts on, etc." Drunkenly I look out the window to see some smoke, and holy crap, there's smoke in the cabin. The lady next to me explains we have only been in the air 10 minutes and are about to make an emergency landing in Santa Barbara. I have a 2-year-old. The other day, I ran to the bathroom and he was sitting down, pacified with Daniel Tiger and homemade trail mix. I came back, probably 2 minutes later, to find a mushroom cloud of flour and him standing on top of a bookshelf with a closed jar of peanut butter and covered in flour. The thought processes of toddlers' minds are still an enigma. I wasn't technically gone. I turned my head for, literally, or 3-5 count. I was at the pool with my daughter. She's 2, doesn't care how to swim. But this is a graded pool, where the depth slowly inclines up to a shore-like edge. She was jumping up and down, splashing in the puddles, and I was sitting about 10 feet away watching her while talking to a friend. I was watching her and talking, when he said something funny and I turned to give him a look. I looked back, and my daughter, in a matter of a few seconds, had taken a few steps to deeper water, about 1.52 ft, and was under the water, silently rolling around. I never cleared 10 feet so fast in my life. I scooped her up and set her on her feet. It was shallow enough to stand. I'm guessing she just lost her footing and couldn't right herself and panicked. No coughing up water, barely a sputter. She was fine. But man, when they say it can happen in seconds, they aren't kidding. Whoever they are, I was barely fazed by it too. We continued our day like normal. My friend said, "I know you're okay now, but it's gonna hit you later. If you need to talk, call me." He was right. That night I replayed events in my head and kept thinking. I looked away for a second. What the heck happened? I just couldn't get the image of her flailing so silently in the water out of my head. No one else noticed her. What if I hadn't? I cried pretty hard at the idea of losing her to such a tragic accident and vowed to be much more vigilant at the pool or any other body of water. I also got her a life jacket that she hates wearing. The end. Several years ago, I was in the process of making dinner and had left a plate of flour tortillas on the kitchen bar. Went out to the garage with my husband for about 90 seconds to look at something. Hear a very loud thud from kitchen. That thud was our dog jumping down off the bar, and now standing in the middle of the kitchen, wolfing down flour tortillas like they were going out of style. What makes it funny is that our bar is about 42 inches high, and the dog was a basset hound. A freaking fat stubby-legged basset hound. To this day, we still can't figure out how he got up there or how he got down without breaking a leg. There's no power in the universe quite like a hungry dog in search of food. Back in grade 11, I had my friend and his girlfriend come over to hang out on a night that my parents went home. The worst part was that we weren't drinking. We were all playing Mario Party. I got up and went to the bathroom for literally 30 seconds. I come back and they are completely naked and freaking on my bed. I had a baby pet turtle. I left Sherman Myrtle in a Tupperware dish on my nightstand. I come back, maybe 5 minutes later. Turtle is on top of a separate dresser, out of his container. One of your siblings or your folks was messing with you, or it was the hobo that lives in your attic. Either way, I actually have that moment to my friends. I was outside at a house party and needed to pee. There was someone in the bathroom, so I told my friends I was going to go around to the side of the house to pee where no one could see. A few minutes later, I came back all bloody and dirty and they freaked out. What I didn't know was there was a steep ditch right next to the house. Being a female, if I pee outside, I try to support myself by doing a sort of wall sit so I don't wind up peeing on my legs or clothes. So I pulled my pants down and tried to do the wall sit on the side of the house. I was crazy drunk, so I lost my balance due to the incline of the ditch. Scraped myself up on the brick wall trying to catch myself, and tumbled pants down in the ditch. I pulled myself up, went back to my friends and said, "I think it's time for me to go home." Just last night, after putting the kids to bed and having a bit of a workout, my wife told me to shower off and get to the bedroom. I jumped in the shower, scrubbed up, rinsed and was out in a matter of minutes. She was already asleep. There's nothing more fun than trying to go to sleep once the launch sequence has been initiated. This has happened several times with me and my partner. I go off to the bathroom to initiate liftoff, only for her to ask why I was in the bathroom for so long. "You were fast asleep, honey, and now there's no more fuel left in the tank." Years back I had a little thing celebrating my new apartment. Just a few close friends and a couple of not so close friends. We were having a good time. Drinks were being had and eventually the need for greasy takeout food was too strong to ignore. Everyone was pretty marinated, some more than others, but driving was out of the question. Me and my bro take everyone's orders and we stroll to the taco place around the corner. When we return, most everyone is on the porch having smokes. Everything seemed normal. When I walk into the apartment, there he is. We'll call him Waldo. Passed out on my couch, vomit running down the side of his face, vomit dripping down my new couch, vomit on my brand new rug. Apparently, when we left they started chugging whiskey, which obviously didn't agree with old Waldo. I only went for tacos. Next time Waldo goes for the tacos. Just today, a friend of mine went to the toilet and when she came back her boyfriend had dislocated his elbow and been sent to the hospital. I got up to get salsa and when I returned my plate was upside down on the floor and both of my microwave burritos were missing. And my cat was nowhere to be found. I went upstairs to pee and my cat ripped through a McDonald's bag and ate my entire cheeseburger in the 3 minutes that I was up there equals. So, my wife is pregnant right now. First trimester is pretty exciting. We were at our friend's house, and I was helping my bro cook some burgers. Wife was hanging out in the kitchen with my buddy's wife, and was holding their baby. I'm walking back and forth between the grill and the kitchen. "Get a fork, get a plate, oh, get that seasoning, etc., etc." Anyway, I'm in and out of the kitchen for less than a minute and see my wife puking into their kitchen sink, with the entire front of her clothes covered in baby poop. I guess their baby decided to drop the mother of all poop bombs right in my wife's lap. First trimester, so she's totally sensitive to smells and whatever, but she totally lost all of her cookies right in front of everyone at our friend's house. Don't worry, that memory won't even register on the big list of embarrassing crap, I promise. I was cooking dinner one night. I let the dog off his lead in the backyard and went back to cooking. I was only gone for 2 minutes. When I went back outside, the neighbor's bull mastiff killed my dog and was making his escape. I was too stunned, too hurt to do anything. I reported the neighbor to animal control and the offending dog was taken away. Ever since, it's been a daily contest of wills, me wanting to throw bricks at the guy's house. I have an internal conflict every day, months later, and still do. He was the best dog I ever owned. Someone used a fire extinguisher to put out a grease fire, and it was the carbon type, so the cook thought it was the proper fire extinguisher, and regardless of it being the right kind, it was still the wrong thing to do. The problem was there was a huge vat of grease at the bottom of the rotisserie, and when you turn on a fire extinguisher, the spray comes out with such incredible force it splashed all the grease out of the rotisserie. Then that grease is all over the floor and it reignited, spreading fire all over the floor. When you have a huge vat of grease burning, there's only one of two things you can do. Close the door to the rotisserie and let it burn itself out, or toss a bucket of cold grease into the fire. There was a bucket of cold grease near the fire and I kicked it over, put the fire on the floor out. Then I closed the doors to the rotisserie to let it burn itself out. Now a lot of people are thinking, why is cold grease so effective at putting out a fire? Isn't it like tossing gasoline onto a fire? The answer is no. It's nothing like tossing gasoline onto a fire. A cold grease just doesn't catch fire easily. It has to be heated up first, which takes time. The grease cooking in a rotisserie has been heating up for several hours. The reason why the grease in the rotisserie caught fire was that grease is extremely hot, and something pushed it over the ignition point. Grease does not mix with water, so water can't put out a grease fire. But grease will mix with other grease. If you dump a bucket of cold grease into a grease fire, what happens is the temperature of the total volume of grease becomes a compromise between the cold and hot, depending on the both heat and volume. If you have enough cold grease, the temperature of the burning grease will be lowered below the ignition point, putting out the fire. If you have a vat of burning grease, if you spray a powerful hose of anything directly into it, it does not matter what kind of fire extinguisher it is, if it's powerful enough, and most of them are, will cause the grease to splash out of the vat and spray all over the kitchen, setting your kitchen on fire. So keep that in mind. If you're using a fire extinguisher, don't jam it into the grease fire. Stand back and use it from a distance. Well, crap. Till. Had a hotel room on Bourbon Street. Went back to the room at bar closing time, waiting for the bartender we'd met to get off work to take us to an after-hours party. Since the hotel locks the outer doors, I go down to the street to check if he's made it. When I went into the hotel, Bourbon Street was full of fun and merriment. When I went out a few minutes later, it looked like a freaking post-apocalyptic video game. Screaming H, men fighting, small fires. That Super Bowl where Janet Jackson was topless. Well, lucky me, I had to pee right before the halftime show fiasco because it was getting really boring. I whipped my dinghy out and everybody started screaming and hooting and I had a mini heart attack and peed on the back of the toilet. Now anytime I feel myself get bored, I think about that day and it forces me to stick through the boredom in case there is suddenly boobies. I hate that incident. First time we're Carolina in the Super Bowl, with an exciting fourth quarter score a ton, and all everybody remembers about that game was Janet's tit. I was client-side APM on a construction site, basically there to help oversee construction and make sure its impact on the school was minimal. We're moving a laboratory sink to build a new classroom, relocate the old one. There's an escutcheon on the sink pipe that is preventing us from removing it from the cabinetry. I tell our foreman, hey, don't worry about this right this second. Let me talk to our build maintenance engineers about it, knowing they had the tool that could help. I also wanted to get them to turn the line off because it wasn't as easy as they had said it would be to remove it. The foreman turns and looks at his left-hand guy, says, "Okay, we won't do nothing until you return." I step out of the classroom and go maybe 20 feet down the hall to radio engineering when I hear, "Holy frick, what did I just say?" The assistant started poking at something in the pipe, a ceiling ring something, and somehow knocked something off in such a way that the entire line opened up and literally started shooting out water at fire hydrant speeds across our very very expensive science room. I stood for nearly 10 whole minutes in front of the stream trying to catch as much water as I could in one of those plastic waste paper basket, and then dumping it down the bathroom next door. I was basically trying to shield anything built into the room that was used by the science class from a fire hose. All I can say is frick that guy, and frick engineering. The valve to shut the line off was in the classroom below but took them 10 whole fricking minutes. More damage than when they drilled straight into the vertical water main in the building. My girls were, like, 4 and 6 years old. One summer evening I left them at home with their dad while I ran to the store to pick up a few things. I couldn't have been gone an hour. When I pull into the driveway and get out of the car I can hear both girls screaming and their dad roaring. I SIND straighten my shoulders and walk into the house braced for whatever disaster is awaiting me. I go through the front door, round the corner and see my husband lying in the hallway holding his head. His roars have subsided to a painful groaning. I hear scuffling behind the girl's closed bedroom door. I step over my husband's prone form and burst into the bedroom and catch the girls in the process of climbing out their bedroom window. I got everyone settled down and finally got the story out of them. It seems my husband thought it would be hilarious to scare the girls, so he got out the scream mask, put it on and tiptoed down the hall and stuck his head through the half-open door. Before he could make any scary sounds, a 6-year-old glanced up and saw him and immediately leapt to her feet and slammed the door, pinning his head. When he recoiled from that impact he staggered backward, cracking the back of his head on our bedroom door frame and collapsed to the floor. The girls were planning to escape next door. The moral of the story is don't mess with defenseless little girls, sometimes they'll frick you up. Your girls are awesome and did exactly what they should do if there was an intruder. If you have or had small kids, this question has come to your mind more than once. The one stuck to my mind is when I was cooking dinner for my visiting sister and his BF. They were on their way to visit my 4-year and my pregnant ex-wife. I left the pan for 45 seconds to do something else and came to my 4-year vomiting over his own poop, strategically positioned in front of the entrance door, and my pregnant ex-wife vomiting over the pan because she couldn't deal with the smell sight. Oh, and my sister was ringing the door's bell. I had to call for a pizza. Baby powder everywhere. I'm talking in the silverware drawer, under the couch, inside the couch, on top of the picture's frames. It clogged, broke the vacuum. I slipped on a thin layer of it trying to get the vacuum out of the closet. Baby powder on tile is very dangerous. I hate baby powder. I wanted to try tattooing. Bought a gun practice on some oranges and stuff. Had some friends come over and one of them volunteered to get a simple little bomb done on him. Did it. Turned out good. Went for a smoke break for 5 minutes and then came back into the rest of the guys tattooing themselves with the same dang needle. One of them tattooed a circle on their arm by literally holding it like a child holds a crayon and just did overlapping circles. Imagine you do a light sketch with a pencil to make a circle, and the other tattooed his ex-wife's name across his forearm in a similar fashion. It started okay but slowly got bigger and worse near the end of the name. Serious WTF moment. You got some dumb friends, dude. A regular day in the gym, was working out my back. A couple guys were doing flat bench and shooting the crap. I had to go take a leak, was gone for 2 minutes, tops. Come back to see one of the guys sporting a pec tear with a spectacular purple bruise blossoming on it. He was crying, practically bawling while a doc tended to him. Turns out, while ego benching, he tried to do 405 and paid the price. Was at work, went outside to grab a smoke, come back in and one of the receptionists that I had a crush on is blushing and everyone else is laughing. I ask what happened and they let me know that she got her belly button pierced the night before and wanted to show everyone, but was wearing a dress. She decided to flip up her dress to show everyone anyway and forgot she wasn't wearing any underwear. Still can't believe I missed that one. Susan, Do it again, I wasn't watching. Here's a depressing one. My mom picked me up from middle school at 11 a.m. for an orthodontist's appointment. She dropped me back at school at 12:30 p.m. I walked back into my classroom to see that the entire room was silent and most had red eyes from crying. The teacher quietly took me aside and told me that one of my best friends had been horribly injured in an accident in the gym and likely wasn't going to make it. He died while being airlifted to the hospital. I wanted my wife to have a good morning, so I made breakfast for her. It was pancakes with her favorite syrup and a glass of orange juice. I thought it would be nice for her to be able to eat it in bed, so I woke her up and brought her the tray. I realized I forgot a napkin, so turn around to go get one. And as soon as I make it out of the room, I hear silverware hitting together and a really sad voice say, "Oh, come back." I turn around and there's orange juice everywhere, pancakes on the bed, and she's looking at me like I did something wrong. Evidently she reached over for a Kleenex and her juice started tipping on the tray and she panicked and overcompensated. Trying to make her day nice, made it awful. Story of my wife's life. One night in college I left my apartment to go to a party at my girlfriend's place. I headed over early, maybe 8, to just hang out and drink beer because college girl parties are weird and dumb and start at 11 for no goddamn reason. But I digress. About an hour later I realize I'd forgot my weed, so I walked back to my place. I hear music thumping and figure there's no way it's my apartment. My roommates weren't big party people. Get outside the door and it's def my place. I open the door. The lights are off. A strobe light is going. Weird techno-ish music is blasting. Most of the dudes present are shirtless, seemingly tripping balls, and totally covered in red paint for some reason. Unintelligible yelling in my direction as I walk in. Just need my pot, you guys have fun, I have to go now, bye bye. My wife had to be induced for our first child. We had been sitting in the hospital for about 9 hours when I asked her if it would be okay with her if I went and got a drink. She said fine. So I went to the lounge that was about 20 feet from our hospital room, put in the money, grabbed the can that dropped and walked back to my room to see a nurse stationed at my wife's feet telling her to push while mom too. B had started Lamar's breathing. I had been gone less than 30 seconds. I swear those maternity nurses were just lying in wait. I was at a wedding helping my cousin set up chairs. My uncle left us alone for about 5 minutes. He came back to find my cousins and I being escorted out for trying to catch the goldfish in the fountain. We're all in our 20s. I successfully caught the most, by the way. I left a patient who was not confused alone for like 5 minutes. Came back to all 3 IVs ripped out. Blood and pizza sauce everywhere. While the incredibly obese patient hiked his leg over the bed rails, firing crap all over the floor and screaming, "Bombs away. Jesus freaking Christ." I was a highly tense family gathering of my wife's family, and was congratulating myself on having, during the 3 hours we were there, kept everyone from yelling at each other as we prepared to say goodbye, and I popped outside to see if I needed to ask someone to move their car so we could leave. In 20 seconds, I heard very loud shouting involving my wife, her sister, brother and mother. She still isn't talking to her sister or mother. This was 4 years ago. Europeans who visited America, what was your biggest WTF moment? In 2015 I went to Florida. We walked past a crazy golf place and a guy was holding an alligator in his arms. He also told me he had an 8-foot alligator in the back. I'm from England, so I don't think I'll ever quite get over just how casual he was having a freaking alligator in his arms. That's very much a regional thing. My wife is from Florida and isn't fazed by alligators. I'm from Georgia, Alabama and I won't go near the dang things. Not European but Arab. Went to some diner in Portland, Oregon and I ordered coffee. Halfway in my coffee she asked me if I wanted a refill. I politely declined, telling her I was short on cash. She laughed and said refills are free of charge. And to top off my amazed reaction she complimented my shirt. Needless to say, she cured my hangover and I fell in love. Had my cousins come over from Latvia for a few weeks. They never got over the absolute size of stores like Walmart and the sheer amount of products offered. When I ordered a cappuccino at IHOP and it came in a bowl-sized mug with cream on top and was filled with sugar and vanilla. IHOP was madness. I think my order was about 9,000 calories. Not European, I'm Australian, but went to a Walmart in Arkansas. It was just like stepping into the people at Walmart page. Comma Walmart, comma Arkansas, ha, you jumped in with both feet right there. European gone to Texas, the difference in religion is astounding. It's so much more prevalent in people's lives here. There are some beautiful churches in Europe, but they don't seem to have the same spirit as Texas. Also, holy frick, the driving distances are immense. An hour commute in the morning is normal for people. A lot of US states are larger than most EU nations, yes. Back in 1987 and asking for a burger and chips, then sat wondering why the hotel waitress looked at me funny. Then my food turned up. Crisp with a burger wasn't a thing back then. On the other hand, if you ask for fish and chips, everyone in the US will know what you mean. The only time that chips means French fries in the US is if it's preceded by the words fish and. So I've been living in the States for 3 years now, originally from England. I turned to my co-worker one day and asked, can I borrow a rubber? She proceeds to do a double take and said, what? I asked again, and told her it was to rub out the mistakes I made with a sketch I was working on. She proceeds to burst out laughing and explains to me what a rubber really means. I should have said eraser. While in Florida, we went through a drive-thru and the lady couldn't understand what I was ordering regardless of how slowly and carefully I spoke, so I decided to go inside instead where the lady behind the counter couldn't understand me either. I am a northern Brit but not too broad an accent. My little sister had to put on her Florida accent to order for us. The manager who eventually took the order said she was sorry as the staff were only used to normal English lol. Boston. Didn't notice I had left Europe. Houston. The people were as friendly as they were huge and loud. Hugely loud and loudly huge, I guess. Nashville and other places I went kinda blend together in my head, except for the delicious food. Oh, and the person who asked if my country had coins and traffic lights. What? Yes? I mean, what? I was extremely surprised that in fast food restaurant you will find unlimited soft drinks from time to time, like a refill cup, yet people pay extra for a bigger cup, so they don't have to walk too often, I guess. While walking around Austin, random people would just give me a hey, how's it going as they walked past. In the UK, if someone even looks like they might glance in your direction, it probably means they're about to try selling you something. I probably offended a couple of them with how defensive I seemed. Come to New York, you'll like it. We won't even look in your general direction. There's freaking flags everywhere. The American flag density per square km is so much higher than any other place I've been. It's like every other house has a flag. The number of American flags on display very dramatically shot up after 9/11. This is not me. I read a story of four Germans who had just finished high school and were going on a USA road trip of beer and weed in some places. They didn't find out the drinking smoking age was 21 until they got there. I had a foreign exchange student friend come from Germany when we were about 19/20, and he ordered a beer the first time we went out to eat. He was shocked when they asked for it and denied him a drink. We laughed and asked if he knew that 21 was the drinking age here. He just replied, yes, I heard that, but it seemed too ridiculous. I thought no one would care. Jacksonville, Florida, 2010. During some jazz blues street festival, a lady across the street shouts hi there. I shout back hello. She clocks my accent immediately. Britain, Wurubriatayane. I nod slightly. I go back there in a month for the first time since. I left my hotel in Texas at 7 a.m. Stopped at McDonald's and got enough breakfast sandwiches to last me through lunch. I then stopped at a gas station to get gas and cigs and two cokes. I gunned it through Texas, sometimes going over 90 miles an hour. I stopped one more time to go to the toilet and get gas and snacks. At 7:30 p.m. I stopped at the hotel to spend the night. I was still in Texas. From Beaumont to El Paso is almost as far as Paris to Budapest. Was at a 4th of July party in the middle of the woods, chilling, having a great time and some beers, zip lining from a tree into a lake. It was like a 90s film come true. Out of nowhere, this redneck comes in with an AR-15 slung over his shoulder shouting, let's shoot some crap up. Naturally, I shat myself and made to run into the woods before realizing he was just a guest who turned up a bit late. He turned out to be a really nice guy. This is hilarious. I'm Canadian, not European, but still the first time I saw a dude walk by me, into a bank no less, and he stood near a cop, with a gun on a holster, and not cause crap. It blew my mind. It was somewhere in Texas, it was something like 30 years ago, and for all I know he was breaking the law and just didn't get caught in the minute or so I remember looking at him. I went into a Pizza Hut in Nevada and the guy working the register was open carrying. It's normal here. All arguments for or against aside. The space. You guys have so much unused and touched space. It's crazy. In Europe there is barely anywhere that isn't owned or isn't being used. In Europe we have protected forests. In America you have some unrestricted, uncontrolled forests that are massive. Tell that to Scandinavia. They have all this freezing cold land and no people to populate it with. It blows me away that Stockholm has less than a million people in it and it's the biggest city in Sweden. I grew up in suburbs that were more populated than that. I'm actually in NYC right now, so that was good timing. I'm from the UK. Yesterday I went to Central Park and there were literally two guys just driving around on Segways with giant butt snakes around their necks. Occasionally they'd take them off and drape them around the nearest random person. I was actually frozen with horror. Clearly this is more of a regular occurrence. I also saw even more of these snake dudes at the Statue of Liberty today. Maybe they are following me. In Florida, how amazingly friendly people were whilst talking absolute nonsense to make us happy. We are from Wales in the UK. This guy at a burger store asked where we were from and started to tell us how he loves Wales, then went on about how his mum lives there. We asked what part of Wales does she live? His reply, Paris, I think. Americans don't have mums, so he must have been lying. I'm an Aussie who visited USA. Hope it's okay for me to crash this thread. We loved our visit, loved the whole bloody place, but I was absolutely gobsmacked when I found Fruit Loops with marshmallows. I genuinely did not think it was possible to make Fruit Loops more unhealthy, but you guys did it. Love your work. We're here for a good time, not a long time. I used to live in Canada but live in the US now. It was really weird to me that when I use my debit card it can be ran as debit or credit. Didn't make sense. And to my knowledge doesn't really make a difference. I knew there was a difference. It just seemed strange when I first moved to the US. In the US there is a law protecting credit card users. From back in the early 70s I think, that gives you legal recourse against theft and other things. You don't have those protections with a debit card. Since the credit card companies charge less for debit transactions, the store would prefer you do debit. As a US consumer you are much safer using credit. This in 2013. Paying water bill by sending a check in the mail. Giving credit card information through the phone. The entire tipping concept. When I was in Las Vegas I saw this 300 kilogram specimen pouring 3 packets of sugar sweetener into his Pepsi at the breakfast buffet. Most Americans would think that whole sentence is freaking disgusting. I went to Vegas and saw a homeless guy with a sign that said kick me in the balls for $20. This huge dude was well up for it. He had a bit of a run up and hoofed him right in the knackers. This poor tramp was rolling around in agony but got his money. As an American, this bothers me too. I had that moment in almost every restaurant. Way too much food on my plate and even a small Coke is a large Coke in my opinion. What's interesting is to see the differences from north to south as well. When I visited the south for the first time I ordered a medium meal at a Mexican place and was handed a tray full of food and a drink that was definitely a large up north. Later on for science I bought a large drink and honestly they're like a liter or more. But dang. I love me some sweet tea now. Went to Florida for holiday and it felt like every third car was a Toyota Corolla I think. There was an absurd amount of the exact same car in mostly the same color, red, and it was blowing my mind. D. Pretty stereotypical stuff. Couple we stayed with were hugely nice but very religious and overweight. They voted for Obama and then Trump. Also drove us 4 hours for a day trip. The bread is inexplicably sweet. A nice healthy pancake with blueberries for breakfast was actually 5 pancakes with blue syrup and whipped cream. I could get used to root beer floats though. A rare sentiment from a European. Mostly I hear that Europeans think root beer tastes like toothpaste. My brother lived in Tampa for a while. When I went to visit any American I spoke to told me their life story, their military career, how many jobs they have, kids they have, how old they are, etc. I took a 40-minute trip in an Uber from the Keys to Weber and, I'm not kidding, this guy talked, seemingly without taking a breath, the entire time. As a Brit this was very very uncomfortable. Ugh, I'm American and I hate talkative Uber Lyft drivers. I'm hoping in the future the app has an option to choose quiet ride. 10 days in Houston, Texas. The amount of Mexican food available, Chipotle, etc, caught my anus by surprise. I had more than enough time to wonder why there is so much freaking water in the toilet bowl. I'm sure it means nothing, but it hurts my Texan heart that you had all that Mexican food available and Chipotle is the example you choose. Us Germans have the reputation of being deferential to all kinds of authority, and maybe deservedly so, but when there is some trashy drama going on in a US supermarket, there always seems to be someone who at some point threatens to call the manager if those shenanigans don't stop right away, sounding like they are about to conjure up some omnipotent eldritch deity. Which executive powers do store managers have in America? Are there states where they can invoke some kind of castle doctrine and pull a gun on you? It's just a way to have someone come over and properly defuse the situation by either giving some kind of discount or booting the person from the facility. Some places only the manager has the authority to do either without getting in trouble from the higher-ups. I'd go into a store, and everything had a price on it. Then I'd take it to the checkout, and all of a sudden they'd add a load of extra charges on top of it. Why not just include it in the price so I know what I'm going to have to pay for it? People, things that happen in Vegas don't count. Of course you're going to see weird and outlandish crap here, that's what the city is known for. Holy crap guys, I bought weed legally at a cafe and then fricked a prostitute, legally. Sure I was in Amsterdam but like wow it was weird. Just the sheer size of everything. Cars are all absolutely gigantic. In Fort Lauderdale, there seemed to be a parade of people driving on a Sunday. Huge frick off trucks, Mustangs, Corvettes, all of the Bald Eagle Murica cars. The food was gigantic. In Mexican restaurant, we ordered a starter and main course each. They asked do you want a guac and chips whilst you wait. They give us a literal bucket of guacamole and the equivalent of about 8 family bags of Doritos. TBH, I felt like I was in a film the whole time I was there. Huge frick off trucks, that made me laugh. Not me, but a good friend of mine moved from France to Florida. He said he was having a smoke on his balcony when he heard someone in his apartment complex scream "God damn it, put the freaking gun down." He doesn't smoke much on his balcony anymore. That's good. Smoking is deadly. In a reverse statement, everyone in Europe seems to know everything about American politics, but I can only name the German Chancellor Merkel. Went to New Jersey for work. The classics. Portions are enormous and public restroom stalls might as well not be there considering the size of all the gaps. Toilets have a weird shape and hold too much water. Also everyone is so polite and talkative. As someone who is really crap at making conversation myself, this made me feel a lot less awkward talking to people, so that was nice. 1. Waiter takes your card away at the burger joint. 2. People with guns on their hip while doing their everyday Wednesday stuff. I'm from the Nordics, not used to the gun mania. 3. Attended a wedding. Everyone wearing suits that were a 2-3 numbers too big. 4. Glass size when you go out to buy a soda. Large has a new meaning for me now. 5. Prevalence of religion in everyday life. Where I'm from nobody really attends church or talks about religion. Didn't realize that it played such a big role in the South. 6. Crap people ask you about regarding the Nordics made me smile. 8/10, like the place, would visit again. Went to Florida in 2014. I'm from England and there's people in the supermarkets who pack your shopping for you. I always felt so lazy standing there while someone packed my food for me. That space in public toilets doors that allows everyone to see you in your most vulnerable moment. That's the dumbest design I've ever seen. Still rant about it 10 years later. When I went to Europe, the bathrooms made me feel so secure. It's like a small motel. Everywhere I read, I was told that customer service in the USA was amazing. Then I visited NYC and it swung between decent and I can barely be bothered to deal with you. Actually, you are an inconvenience. This may be an NYC thing, however. WTF is up with your bread? Getting a normal whole wheat bread or the likes without 300 grams of sugar is mind-blowingly hard to find. I went to Portland beginning of this year while on a business trip and I couldn't believe the amount of homeless people in downtown Portland. I am not talking about the odd person just sitting in the corner begging. There were a couple of streets with homeless people just strewed on the pavement, some laying down, some sleeping, some just talking to themselves and screaming. This was the first time it really hit me at how big the class divide is in the US and how this is normalized. I would like to believe if this happened in the UK it would be all over the news. And don't get me wrong, we do have homeless in London, but not at this level. While this is happening a few streets over, you've got the most hipster of markets with people talking about stopping gentrification and change the country, and I'm thinking, look a few streets over, mate. Their area about 20 people just on the floor homeless and no one gives a crap. Chicken waffle. My god people, what the frick is wrong with you? It's delicious and I love it, but I feel horrible feeling that way. People have very profound senses of personal space, especially when eating. Sitting down with someone else because there's an empty seat, even in the market or park, makes people genuinely uncomfortable in America. Europeans who visited America, what was your biggest WTF moment? Did a house exchange in New Jersey from UK, and on the second day a neighbor came to the door with an actual cherry pie to welcome us and ask us to dinner. It was 1. A huge confirmation of stereotype. 2. Really touching and sweet. Pie was also wonderful BTW. 3. A bit weird because we knew our neighbors wouldn't give a flying frick and we felt bad colon. Not a WTF moment, but nevertheless a moment I will remember. It was my second trip to California. I was only 18 years old when I got out of the plane. As usual, I had to go through all those security checks. At the last checkpoint, the officer asked me whether I have anything in my suitcase that I didn't mention on TIS CBP thing. Then he asked for drugs and then for alcohol. I honestly answered all questions with no, when surprisingly he asked me why not. A bit confused, I told him that I knew I wasn't allowed to take drugs or drink alcohol in his country. He got interested and asked whether it was different where I'm from. Germany. Here the minimum age is 16 for light beverages like beer and wine and 18 for the other stuff like spirits. He was so interested, he kept asking stuff for like 5 minutes, not even minding the 100 people behind me. When he let me pass, he instantly turned towards the guy in the other checkpoint was like, hey, did you know? Double quote. Damn, I just realized a lot of people's first experience in America are these clowns at SAR. First thing I saw after sitting down to have my first beer in Portland was some guy walking in the middle of the street, half butt dressed as a ninja, with 2 swords on his back. Oh, and before that some homeless guy told me and my friend to go back to your country. Then some slightly hippie looking girl apologized for his behavior. We just laughed at how scripted the situation felt and went to have the beer above. Also, when you play Grand Theft Auto you hear strangers on the street yelling and talking about weird crap. That just felt exaggerated until I went to the US and realized it actually happens all the time. Ironic that a homeless guy tells you to go home. In 2015 I went to Florida. We walked past a crazy golf place and a guy was holding an alligator in his arms. He also told me he had an 8-foot alligator in the back. I'm from England, so I don't think I'll ever quite get over just how casual he was having a freaking alligator in his arms. That's very much a regional thing. My wife is from Florida and isn't fazed by alligators. I'm from Georgia, Alabama and I won't go near the dang things. I went to pay with card in a restaurant and the waiter just took it and walked off. Sometimes people just give me their card while I'm working. I'm from Canada. And once they hand it to me I panic and have to explain to them that they pay themselves with the machine and that we don't do it for them. We have a lot of Americans coming down from Alaska because I live on a highway that goes from Alaska down to Washington State. not European but Arab, went to some diner in Portland, Oregon and I ordered coffee. Halfway in my coffee she asked me if I wanted a refill. I politely declined telling her I was short on cash. She laughed and said refills are free of charge. And to top off my amazed reaction she complimented my shirt. Needless to say, she cured my hangover and I fell in love. Had my cousins come over from Latvia for a few weeks. They never got over the absolute size of stores like Walmart and the sheer amount of products offered. Excuse me, I ordered a small. My dad was in Tennessee last year. He said it was really strange that everyone says hi to you. I am vacationing in Denmark right now and it feels so cold that nobody says hi to me, even in the elevator. All the prices are pre-tax. When I ordered a cappuccino at IHOP and it came in a bowl-sized mug with cream on top and was filled with sugar and vanilla. IHOP was madness. I think my order was about 9,000 calories. Not European, I'm Australian, but went to a Walmart in Arkansas. It was just like stepping into the people of Walmart page. Comma Walmart, comma Arkansas. Ha, you jumped in with both feet right there. European gone to Texas, the difference in religion is astounding. It's so much more prevalent in people's lives here. There are some beautiful churches in Europe, but they don't seem to have the same spirit as Texas. Also, holy frick, the driving distances are immense. An hour commute in the morning is normal for people. 24 hours open grocery stores, so no excuse if you forgot to buy milk. In Netherlands some days markets close at 6 p.m. Till Europeans all visit Texas. It's the America of America. Back in 1987 and asking for a burger and chips, then sat wondering why the hotel waitress looked at me funny, then my food turned up. On the other hand, if you ask for fish and chips, everyone in the US will know what you mean. The only time that chips means French fries in the US is if it's preceded by the words fish and. So I've been living in the States for 3 years now, originally from England. I turned to my co-worker one day and asked can I borrow a rubber. She proceeds to do a double take and said what? I asked again, and told her it was to rub out the mistakes I made with a sketch I was working on. She proceeds to burst out laughing and explains to me what a rubber really means. I should have said eraser. While in Florida, we went through a drive-thru and the lady couldn't understand what I was ordering regardless of how slowly and carefully I spoke, so I decided to go inside instead where the lady behind the counter couldn't understand me either. I am a northern Brit but not too broad an accent. My little sister had to put on her Florida accent to order for us. The manager who eventually took the order said she was sorry as the staff were only used to normal English lol. Boston. Didn't notice I had left Europe. Houston. The people were as friendly as they were huge. And loud. Hugely loud. And loudly huge, I guess. Nashville and other places I went kinda blend together in my head. Except for the delicious food. Oh. And the person who asked if my country had coins and traffic lights. I. What? Yes? I mean. What? I was extremely surprised that in fast food restaurant you will find unlimited soft drinks from time to time, like a refill cup, yet people pay extra for a bigger cup, so they don't have to walk too often I guess. So much water in your toilet bowls, it's like you're taking your turd for a swim. No, we just love the splash of toilet water on our buttholes when pooping. We make our own bidets, thank you very much. While walking around Austin, random people would just give me a hey, how's it going as they walked past. In the UK, if someone even looks like they might glance in your direction, it probably means they're about to try selling you something. I probably offended a couple of them with how defensive I seemed. Come to New York, you'll like it. We won't even look in your general direction. There's freaking flags everywhere. The American flag density per square km is so much higher than any other place I've been. It's like every other house has a flag. The number of American flags on display very dramatically shot up after 9/11. Your commercials on TV for prescription drugs. We found the disclaimers for the side effects hilarious. Yes, so do Americans. This is not me. I read a story of four Germans who had just finished high school and were going on a USA road trip of beer and herb in some places. They didn't find out the drinking smoking age was 21 until they got there. I had a foreign exchange student friend come from Germany when we were about 19/20, and he ordered a beer the first time we went out to eat. He was shocked when they asked for it and denied him a drink. We laughed and asked if he knew that 21 was the drinking age here. He just replied, "Yes, I heard that, but it seemed too ridiculous. I thought no one would care." Jacksonville, Florida, 2010. During some jazz blues street festival, a lady across the street shouts "Hi there," I shout back "Hello." She clocks my accent immediately. "Britain, Wooroo Briatain." I nod slightly. I go back there in a month for the first time since. I left my hotel in Texas at 7 a.m. Stopped at McDonald's and got enough breakfast sandwiches to last me through lunch. I then stopped at a gas station to get gas and cigs and two cokes. I gunned it through Texas, sometimes going over 90 miles an hour. I stopped one more time to go to the toilet and get gas and snacks. At 7:30 p.m. I stopped at the hotel to spend the night. I was still in Texas. From Beaumont to El Paso is almost as far as Paris to Budapest. A guy casually selling scorpions on the Vegas Strip probably. Was at a 4th of July party in the middle of the woods, chilling, having a great time and some beers, zip lining from a tree into a lake. It was like a 90s film come true. Out of nowhere, this redneck comes in with an AR-15 slung over his shoulder shouting, "Let's shoot some crap up." Naturally, I shat myself and made to run into the woods before realizing he was just a guest who turned up a bit late. He turned out to be a really nice guy. I'm Canadian, not European, but still the first time I saw a dude walk by me, into a bank no less, and he stood near a cop, with a gun on a holster, and not cause crap. It blew my mind. I went into a Pizza Hut in Nevada and the guy working the register was open carrying. It's normal here. All arguments for or against aside. The space. You guys have so much unused and touched space. It's crazy. In Europe there is barely anywhere that isn't owned or isn't being used. In Europe we have protected forests. In America you have some unrestricted, uncontrolled forests that are massive. Tell that to Scandinavia. They have all this freezing cold land and no people to populate it with. It blows me away that Stockholm has less than a million people in it and it's the biggest city in Sweden. I grew up in suburbs that were more populated than that. I'm actually in Nick right now, so that was good timing. I'm from the UK. Yesterday I went to Central Park and there were literally two guys just driving around on Segways with giant butt snakes around their necks. Occasionally they'd take them off and dangle them around the nearest random person. I was actually frozen with horror. In Florida, how amazingly friendly people were whilst talking absolute nonsense to make us happy. We are from Wales in the UK. This guy at a burger store asked where we were from and started to tell us how he loves Wales, then went on about how his mum lives there. We asked what part of Wales does she live? His reply, "Paris, I think." I'm an Aussie who visited USA. Hope it's okay for me to crash this thread. We loved our visit. Loved the whole bloody place. But I was absolutely gobsmacked when I found Fruit Loops with marshmallows. I genuinely did not think it was possible to make Fruit Loops more unhealthy. But you guys did it. Love your work. We're here for a good time. Not a long time. Initially it was people not understanding my accent, but I am used to that now. IDK, I can understand you just fine. So, many flags, they were everywhere. I used to live in Canada but live in the US now. It was really weird to me that when I use my debit card it can be ran as debit or credit. Didn't make sense. And to my knowledge doesn't really make a difference. In the US there is a law protecting credit card users. From back in the early 70s I think. That gives you legal recourse against theft and other things. You don't have those protections with a debit card. Since the credit card companies charge less for debit transactions, the store would prefer you do debit. As a US consumer, you are much safer using credit. This in 2013. Paying water bill by sending a check in the mail. Giving credit card information through the phone. The entire tipping concept. When I was in Las Vegas I saw this 300-kilogram specimen pouring 3 packets of sugar sweetener into his Pepsi at the breakfast buffet. Most Americans would think that whole sentence is freaking disgusting. I went to Vegas and saw a homeless guy with a sign that said kick me in the balls for $20. This huge dude was well up for it. He had a bit of a run up and hoofed him right in the knackers. This poor tramp was rolling around in agony but got his money. As an American, this bothers me too. I had that moment in almost every restaurant. Way too much food on my plate, and even a small Coke is a large Coke in my opinion. What's interesting is to see the differences from north to south as well. When I visited the south for the first time, I ordered a medium meal at a Mexican place and was handed a tray full of food and a drink that was definitely a large up north. Later on for science I bought a large drink, and honestly they're like a liter or more. But dang, I love me some sweet tea now. Went to Florida for holiday and it felt like every third car was a Toyota Corolla, I think. There was an absurd amount of the exact same car in mostly the same color, red, and it was blowing my mind. D. Couple we stayed with were hugely nice but very religious and overweight. They voted for Obama and then Trump. Also drove us 4 hours for a day trip. The bread is inexplicably sweet. A nice healthy pancake with blueberries for breakfast was actually 5 pancakes with blue syrup and whipped cream. I could get used to root beer floats though. I could get used to root beer floats though. A rare sentiment from a European. Mostly I hear that Europeans think root beer tastes like toothpaste. My brother lived in Tampa for a while. When I went to visit, any American I spoke to told me their life story, their military career, how many jobs they have, kids they have, how old they are, etc. I took a 40-minute trip in an Uber from the Keys to Weber and, I'm not kidding, this guy talked, seemingly without taking a breath, the entire time. As a Brit this was very very uncomfortable. Ugh, I'm American and I hate talkative Uber Lyft drivers. I'm hoping in the future the app has an option to choose quiet ride. Every time I fly into JFK I'm appalled at how rude and incompetent all the employees are. So many freaking homeless people in SF. SF was the first place I went in America, and it wasn't just the homelessness that struck me, but how many of them were amputees. We have homelessness in the UK, but they mostly have legs. What is the biggest dating WTF you've experienced? I once got catfished on Tinder. Nothing out of the ordinary, right? Here's the catch. This person had me meet them and acted as if they were not a different person. One of the craziest experiences of my life. Girl told me within 15 minutes of our first meeting that she was having sex with a married co-worker, and her favorite part was seeing him cry in guilt after it was over. Holy crap. Not only doing that but bringing it up on a date 15 minutes in. This is the first comment that actually makes me mad. 1. She was so wrapped up in her phone that she didn't notice I had moved over and started a conversation with some other guests. 2. Asked if she could bring a friend to feel safe, completely understandable, and I was fine with it. Brought her best friend and her date. Both girls ignored us pretty much all night and we left without them. He turned out to be a pretty cool guy though and invited me to join for weekend football, where I made even more friends. A girl I had been seeing for a couple of weeks or so asked me to go with her to a funeral of some guy I didn't know. What I didn't expect was that the funeral was for her fiancé. Got out of there real quick once I realized why everyone was shooting me glares the whole time. I was the side B. Beehive girl. She had a Marge Simpson hairdo, about 18 inches high. She was an actor and couldn't understand why roles would demand she cut her hair, so she turned them down. I went on 3 dates with her just to hear her stories. She was totally oblivious she was the problem. It was like I was watching a soap opera or something, but she was serious. I went on 3 dates with her just to hear her stories. Baller. I went on a Tinder date with this one girl whose bio said something like, "You won't like me, I'm a disaster." Spoiler alert. She was right. But she was pretty attractive, so we went to get tea at a local hipster joint. She was obviously depressed. She told me about her hyper-competent other personality that she sometimes slipped into and how her current life goal was to move several states away from her family and work at a gas station. Even though she was a senior bio major, as the date was ending she freaked out, saying that she forgot her backpack in her last class but doesn't have a car to get back. Apparently her mom dropped her off and then went home, half an hour away in the suburbs. So I took her to get her backpack. Then she told me that she needed me to drive her to her house because it was late and no bus was running out there. So I drove her half an hour back to her parents' house in the suburbs. On the way she told me that she actually has a boyfriend but sometimes likes to see what's out there and that this what our date was. Oh, and she also is pretty sure she is a lesbian but likes the power involved in getting a guy to like her. For some reason we never saw each other again. That's a pretty good example of the term crappy person. I had a guy ask me out on a date, and he suggested a Japanese restaurant I liked. After I ordered, the server asked him what he wanted, and he said he wasn't hungry. I asked him if he wanted to wait until he was hungry, but he said nah, he just wanted to watch me eat. I laughed nervously, thinking it was a joke, but his expression said he wasn't joking. The sushi was good though. This guy went on and on about how he hated promiscuity and W. Later on that night, he tried to go up my shirt and touch my breasts. I stopped him and said, "I thought you hated promiscuity. Code for I hate girls that won't sleep with me." My ex in HS asked me to shave every last hair on my body, like everything except for my eyebrows. I refused, so she dumped me. She is now married to a guy with alopecia. No joke. Hey, I guess there's someone out there for everyone. I once went on a date where I probably said like 5 words. Girl just talked for over an hour and a half, without ever including me in the conversation. Just reminisced, complained, and bragged about her life for over 90 minutes straight. I was so taken aback that I just kind of drove home wondering if that experience was real or not. Just told my husband this story recently when we were driving around the town we grew up in and reminiscing about our teen years. There was a guy who I'd seen around town, usually across the street from a bus stop I used often that I thought was super cute. I wound up meeting him a couple of years later at mutual friend's backyard BBQ and he was cool, and remembered me from that bus stop. Apparently he'd been into me from afar then too. And we decided to move to the front of the house to speak privately and possibly make out. Well, he was super drunk. And we talked and sat next to each other on the front steps, and as the conversation dwindled and our faces moved closer to kiss, inches away from each other, he turns and vomits like a fire hose between his legs. I tried to comfort him a bit and then went back to the party and left shortly after. He felt terrible and asked me out later and I said frick it, let's not totally blow this guy off. Everyone gets super drunk sometimes. Sure, but his idea of a date was taking me to a graveyard in broad daylight to get drunk and I realized he was very, very dumb and I never spoke to him again. I thought this story was gonna end up being about your first date with your husband and he was too drunk to remember it. I was 17. My boyfriend was 20 or 21. We were out to dinner at a fancy place with his parents. He loudly turned to me and said, "By the way, since you won't sleep with me, I'm fricking other girls." With his parents inches away, that dinner became incredibly awkward after that. I was a virgin and wasn't ready yet. Sounds like he had the brain of a 10-year-old. In my JC days, I had a girl invite me over for a study date. Her dad was home and we actually studied at the kitchen table. Dad seemed cool from the little bit of conversation we had. Aside from a 7-Eleven run for snacks and cigs, her dad was 10 feet away from us the whole time. I thought the date went well. We talked more than we studied, made tentative plans to see a movie. Couple days later I text her, "What's your weekend looking like so we can check out a flick, grab some dinner?" She replies back, "It's not going to work, she wants someone more forceful." I was like, "What?" Apparently her running to her bedroom a few times for things she forgot was her hint to me I was supposed to follow, and pounce I guess. JC days. I'm struggling to figure out this acronym. For some reason I am stuck on Jesus Christ. I was very new to the city and ended up setting up a date with a girl off Tinder. I spent a lot of time looking into cool bars and suggested a bunch to her, but she ended up really wanting to go to a certain bar, like would not take no for an answer. I looked it up. It looked okay. Nothing really that special. I figured she had some sort of thing with the people who worked there where she could escape if the date went bad. And fast forward to the date. It's going really well. She's absolutely gorgeous and the conversation is really easy. I bring up the choice of the bar and why she was so adamant on this one. She said her ex-BF works here. That throws me off. But I figured they broke up a while ago and now are just friends. So I question further, asking how long ago they broke up, and she tells me 2 weeks ago, and that he is currently our bartender. I look over at the bar, and this massive 280-pound guy is giving me the biggest death stare. I was wondering all night why he was being a dong to me. Now I understood. Got out of there pretty quickly after that. A guy I saw for less than a month, if I recall correctly, took it upon himself to vent any problems relating to the relationship that we had to a male friend of mine he didn't really know at all. In retrospect, he was a peculiar guy in many different ways, and this hampered his ability to make his own friends to whom he could vent and get advice from. At the time, however, it was incredibly strange for my friend, who explicitly told him several times, "Dude, as he either is my friend, not you. I have no idea who you are. Please don't come to me with complaints about her." I think it took about 4 or 5 tries, and my dumping him, for him to understand it. Some guy took my glasses, ran out of the restaurant with them. I got a text like 15 minutes later of him taking a selfie in them at his place. He said if I wanted them back, I would have to come over to his. This was while I was in the Marines. I met up with this girl from POF. All seemed well from our chats and texting, so we decided to meet up for a date in Palm Springs. Nothing out there yet. I get there to find out she has kids, which she brought along but never told me about even having kids whatsoever, and without missing a beat, she asks me right there to have a contract marriage. I spit my drink out ASAP while she tried to explain how it would benefit the both of us. I just looked at her with a stern look, told her to get her crap together, told her to lose my number, and walked the heck out. She had previously told me how irresponsible her sister was. Her sister had received a positive result for herpes. Sister thought it meant she was clean and didn't have it. I don't get the logic either. A few weeks later, we had been seeing each other pretty casually. She mentions that her sister wanted to swap. Yep, no thanks. On a third or fourth date, I went back to his apartment to have a glass of wine. We had a great evening until near the end he said, "Wow, I can't believe you passed almost every test." Turns out he set up his apartment with small girlfriend tests. He made sure there was little to no toilet paper to see if I would change the roll, if I rinsed my dishes, if I turned off lights behind me, where I put my jacket and shoes. Needless to say, there were no further dates. That was no man. That's his mother wearing his skin. Testing you. Not major. Online match. Meet for dinner. Tells me she is lactose intolerant. Proceeds to order food with lots of dairy products. The restaurant was small and in an old house, so the bathroom was a single closet style that happened to be less than 10 feet from our table. Her food upset her, so she uses that loudly and leaves the door open after she's done. Yup. Still asks if we can go get ice cream afterwards. That girl likes to party. I had been dating this guy for about a month, and I knew he was pretty freshly out of another relationship. We were having beers on a patio at a tap house nearby, and his phone rings and he answers it and proceeds to talk to who I realized was his ex. They were arguing and talking about their breakup, all while he was still sitting at the table with me. After about an hour and a few beers later, a guy at the table next to me gave me kind of a nod to join his table. I did. We talked about what and butthole the other guy was being. We spent the next couple hours chatting. Douchebag left when his phone call was over, and my new friend and I ended up dating for a year and we're still friends to this day. I've been on and off the dating app life for a couple of years now. I just got my first big boy job and moved to a new area. I matched with this cute girl who was a junior in college nearby. We had a nice first date, got coffee and walked around. We set plans to grab lunch that weekend. During lunch we decided to go on an impromptu hike. I drove us to my house to grab some water, snacks, change clothes, and we had a nice hike. Everything was going pretty darn well. We texted and kept up throughout the week. That Friday I was at a friend's house. We had a few drinks, so I didn't feel comfortable driving back home. He didn't have an Android charger and my phone was dying, so I sent a courtesy text to her to let her know I was going to be out of commission for a while. The next morning, I get home and charge in my phone. After a few seconds I get a slew of text messages, around 50, all from her. It was a spiral into insanity. At first she told me to go have fun and have a good night. Then it went from that to, "Hey, are you free too?" Why aren't you talking to me? And near the latter, she mentioned she drove by my house and didn't see my car. She accused me of sleeping around. Basically, any and every insecurity got projected onto me within a couple of hours, all while I was asleep. I called it off immediately. She probably had some deeper issues and I hope she has gotten help is happy. It was just the transition from a few nice dates to that night that really made me take a step back and go, what the actual frick? I said something the guy I was dating at the time didn't like, so to punish me he punched himself 3 times in the jaw and knocked out a tooth. Should've kept saying it for a TKO. A year ago I met up with a girl I met on a dating site. We went out for coffee and had a good talk about movies and video games. Then everything got weird when she asked if she could read me some of her poetry about her ex-boyfriend cheating on her. She proceeded to sob in public in the middle of the poem, and wouldn't stop until she was finished with her very long poem despite being a blubbering, sniffling mess. There was no second date. Her next date heard her poems about her date with the guy who didn't like poetry. Her date after that was easier, because she could just reuse the poems from the previous date. On 2 separate occasions, I've gone home with a guy after a perfectly lovely first date to find an array of BDSM toys laid out on the bed, ready for use. Don't get me wrong, I'm generally down, but you can't just spring that on someone. Guys, there has to be a discussion before you bring out a leather hood and the Flogatron 3000. In both cases, there was no second date. He made me Uber to him, $20 one way to a nice building, so we could Uber together to a bar by my condo. Cost me $40 to go somewhere 2 blocks from my place. I don't get it. He then pulled a pint of Svedka out and chugged it in one shot at the bar. He ordered 2 drinks, and shoved me the bill. He hit on the bartender in a language I don't speak. She was very uncomfortable. He then asked me where I lived, told him the name of the building. He decided that he liked my building better than his, and wanted to stay with me for a few days to check it out to buy a penthouse. I said no, but he could contact a realtor. He went batshit. I look down and he's on Tinder while screaming at me. He showed me a girl and said he was going to frick her if I didn't let him in. Told him to go for it. I am not interested. He followed me the whole walk to my place, stumbling, grabbing my arm and screaming at me. He tried to steal my purse. The police ended up coming up to me and holding him long enough for me to get home. He sent me a series of bizarre threatening messages at night, and kept randomly messaging me that he loved me. I am a bee. I am his only hope. I am going to get raped. I posted about it on FB and some other friends had run-ins with him. Guess he's homeless and was getting by staying at people's houses and borrowing their stuff to look like he was somewhat wealthy to con more people. If I had let him in, it'd have been screwed. It was a crap show of events for a first date. Not gonna bother doing the full version, so here is the short. Took girl on a hiking date. She brought a machete. She stripped naked and started whacking through the foliage with her blade, and then got mad at me and threw roadkill at me. My type. Met a girl for a first date at a local bar. We had a few too many, so decided to Uber back to my place. Girl decides she's going to try and polish my lap rocket in the backseat of the Uber. I was able to spare myself and the driver of that situation. We get back to my place and start going at it. Next thing I know it's 4 a.m. and she's climbing back into bed. I get up to use the bathroom and step in something. I flick the lights on. There is puke everywhere. Everywhere. Girl puked on the toilet lid, and it splashed all over the bathroom, the sink, the walls, the shower curtain, the mirror. Bile and stout is everywhere. I spent the next 30 minutes cleaning it up, then took a shower, made myself some coffee and thought about what TF just happened. It was an awkward Uber back to our cars that morning for one of us. I didn't have the nuts to tell her what she had done and I don't think she knows. Yo, props to you, dude. He thought it would be mad sexy to whip his dong out right in front of me and order me to suck it while we were sitting in a park in broad daylight. I wish I was kidding. I have also had that happen to me. I went on a very boring date with a very dull, not talkative girl. I tried every couple of minutes to initiate any conversation until I honestly ran dry of something or anything to talk about and decided that it really isn't going to work, so I sat in silence while I finished my drink with complete intention of saying goodbye once I'd finished. 2 sips left and she said something. I kid you not, these were her words. So are you going to kiss me at the end of this? I was in shock and didn't know what to say. She then proceeded to cry and get up saying, I knew I was ugly and walked away. No, it's just your personality. Back in the early 90s, my friend set me up on a blind date with a cousin or something. Can't really remember that part. Anyway, we met at a restaurant and had a decent meal with so-so conversation. But the weird part was she requested a specific table. I didn't really ask why, as it didn't bother me. Occasionally throughout dinner I thought I noticed her doing facial expressions and hand gestures that seemed odd. But the other thing I noticed, after the fact, was she made 3 trips to the restroom. When I got up to use the restroom, on my way back to the table I noticed that where our table was and where she was sitting had her facing the bar area and that there was a lady sitting facing her on the other side of the bar. I kinda thought something was up but shrugged it off. After dinner we went to a bar to have a couple drinks. I was already getting weird vibes but what the heck. We end up sitting at one of the high top tables by the bar and again she sits facing the bar. Facial expressions and hand gestures start up again pretty quick. But this time more obvious. She excuses herself to use the restroom again and I notice that a lady kinda meets her there and they go in together. They come out together and as my date sits at my table the lady walks pat to the bar. Same lady from the restaurant. Now I'm really like WTF, so I really start paying attention to what's going on with her expressions and gestures and it becomes very apparent that she is communicating with this lady. Finally I'm like WTF, who is that lady you are communicating with? She comes clean and says it's her mother. She always tags along on dates. Once we have a few more and I get to know her it won't be so awkward. She just really wants her to settle down so she can have grandkids and wants to be sure the future son-in-law is up to her standards. My response? Waiter, check please. I paid the tab and hauled butt. Imagine some poor guy having to deal with that in the future. Every decision he makes in marriage has to be approved by said mother. I had a date suggest we meet up for drinks. He showed up about 10 minutes late, 2 sheets to the wind. He orders another whiskey and then for about 20 minutes tried to carry on conversation without acknowledging the fact he was clearly incredibly drunk. I casually ask if he drank beforehand and he told me he had a bunch of whiskey beforehand in preparation for the date to calm his nerves. Okay, I get it. Then he continues to explain that he's only drunk because I'm pretty and that he was so eager to make a good impression he decided to drink. And then he puked. Needless to say, the whiskey did not make a good first impression. I had a girl set a whole thing up where she was straddling me in panties only to ask to lick my eye. And, she added, she had a contact kit and stuff so it was safe. So she made a plan to lure me to her place, seduce me, all with the end goal of licking my freaking eyeball. She was hot too. Being an idiot and in high school I left. I wish I'd banged you freaky eye lady. I'm a single father with full custody of my kids. I was dating a girl for a couple months and she asked me why couldn't I just see my kids every other weekend like normal dads. She knew my situation from the very beginning. She also took it upon herself to message my kid's mother and tell her that she needed to step up as a parent so she could have more time with me. She got less time with me after those 2 things. A lot less. No time, to be exact. The second date I had with this fairly attractive girl who, after a few drinks, proceeded to talk about how she was curious about scat play, ran away like my hair was on fire. Pro tip, that's not a good way to put out hair fire. We were talking about the Make-A-Wish Foundation, and I asked him what his wish would be. His response? I'd wanna be able to kill someone. Needless to say, we aren't dating anymore. When I was in college, my buddy at the comic shop asked me what animal I'd be if I had to become a non-human animal. With barely a second's thought I say a dolphin, because they're murderous rapists that are nigh universally beloved. He respected the answer, but was troubled by how quickly it came up. In hindsight, so am I. Several years ago, but the woman that told me she was only in California for rehab for her severe C addiction. Oh, and she was still in love with her ex-boyfriend. But don't worry, he had died 3 months prior from an overdose. Nope. I got sort of abducted on the second date. I got a text saying she wanted to take me somewhere special. I figured she meant a bar nearby or restaurant or something. I'm in Chicago. Nope. Still didn't tell me where she was taking me, and she drove me an hour and a half away to her parents' place for some reason. She was really attractive, so I stupidly went with it. Got there and she started playing with a dead bird on the ground and told me she kept gloves in her car so could pick up dead animals normally. That wasn't enough to deter my meatbag brain as we proceeded to bone. She then tried to get me to take off work and refused to take me back, so I had to take a very expensive Uber to work. Texted me a few hours later how much she missed me. I blocked her immediately after that. Makes for a fun story though. Went on a date with this guy who seemed nice enough. I was having a decent time. Then he drove us out into the middle of nowhere in the pitch black night and locked the doors. I was sure I was gonna die. But after I told him to take me home, he listened, so that's cool. One time I went on a date with a guy who I was classmates with. We'd been flirting with each other for a few weeks, and he seemed cool. The first part of the date was totally normal until he started talking about his faith. He was a member of an Orthodox Presbyterian church outside of town. He believed, as did his church, in the concept of predestination, which meant that he was saved from birth and that I, not a member of his church, was headed straight for heck no matter what I did. He discussed this in length, with excruciating detail. Literally, the entire conversation revolved around me going to heck. I remember asking him point blank why he wanted to date someone doomed to burn in heck, and he told me that it didn't matter what he did, he'd still get into heaven. We never spoke again after that. Lmao, wow, that's not even what the concept of predestination is. Seems he legit had no idea what he was talking about, lol. Reddit. What is the most dumb thanks gift that you've ever received during the holidays? My parents found the Amazon wishlist of someone with the same name as me but not me. Thought it was a bunch of weird items. Decided to not check in with me or any other family member to see if they had the right list. And that's how I, as 24-year-old male, got a maternity body pillow for Christmas. Yeah, but now you have an awesome pillow. The same crack part 3 years in a row from my ex-husband's mother. His new wife was gifted one last year. I'm certain that this woman has a pallet of crockpots stashed somewhere in her house. My ex Mill gave me the same ugly pink shirt and the wrong size the last two Christmases I had to tolerate her. I never wear pink, and both times, the shirt was literally twice as big as it needed to be. My grandparents had a tradition wherein they would give a new Christmas ornament to each grandkid every year. One year, I think I was about 5. My great-grandma gave me the most beautiful ornament. It was elegant and tasteful, and way too pretty for a kindergartner. Everyone in my family was like, "Where did she get that? She hasn't been able to get out to shop yet." Turns out, she stole it all discreet like off the nursing home's Christmas tree. Great-grandma passed in 1989. My mom still has that thing, and we still laugh about it to this day. I love this story. My grandma passed a few months ago and she would make me an ornament each year. I'm sad that I won't be getting one this year, but I'm glad I still have them to remember the tradition. My brother, maybe 11 at the time, took the wrapping paper off his gift from our grandmother. It was in a tape dispenser box. Cue everyone laughing. Ha 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 ha. You got a tape dispenser. We got pretty quiet when it turned out to be a tape dispenser. This only has me feeling sad for Graham. Lesbian Christmas. My parents thought I was a lesbian and wanted to be supportive. They gave me pink triangle earrings and poetry books by lesbians. I'm not gay. Oh 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 girl. I had to come out of the closet as straight to my parents too. My sister bought me a CD she really wanted for herself. When I opened it, she said, "If you don't like it, I'll just take it." I didn't like it. I kept it. Frick her. My dad used to buy me CDs with the knowledge that I'd transfer the music to my iPod, and then not need the physical CD, so he could have it in his car. Perfect system. The very first holiday after my wedding, my mill sent my wife and I, each, separately, the same self-help book on how to survive living with an abusive spouse. Not how to divorce or anything, but how to live in the relationship with an abusive spouse. Not just to her, not just to me, to both of us. Two copies of the book, ha, are just normal. I was a step-grandchild and my grandmother sold Avon to feed her QVC addiction. So while the other six grandchildren got real leather jackets, Diamond jewelry, motocross lessons in 1 year, an actual motocross bike. I got plastic Avon jewelry, for reasons too long to list here. I got placed with my grandparents 2 weeks before Christmas when I was 16. I watched everyone open up their gifts and then one aunt gave me a Walmart bag with some socks in it. Another one told me I should be grateful that the family was taking me in instead of leaving me on the street, and that was my present. 7 aunts and uncles and their spouses, along with my grandparents, and that's how they treated me in a situation that was out of my control. Needless to say, I don't talk to my family anymore. I'm sorry these people were complete shitbags to you in a vulnerable time. No way to treat a kid or teenager going through a tough family situation. Glad you went NC. I used to be a little standoffish at work because I'm shy, sitting on my phone instead of socializing with co-workers. For the Secret Santa, I got my guy a nice bottle of bourbon because I knew that was something he'd like. I in turn got a book about how sitting on your phone too much makes you a butthole. That's either someone being a dong or someone taking a risk not realizing there's the risk of the person in question not liking their joke. When I was around 22, my mum somehow figured out I had a secret crush on Mark Wahlberg. All I got for Christmas that year were Mark Wahlberg DVDs from everyone, in various boxes and wrappings. Like so many Mark Wahlberg DVDs, I stopped saying thanks after probably the 5th one. Your family sounds like a funky bunch. I've been a vegetarian for 20 years now. Last Christmas, my aunt gave me a barbecue cookbook and told me it was because men won't date a woman who doesn't know how to cook them steak. Joke's on you, Auntie Lisa. I'm not single because I'm vegetarian. I'm single because I have a crap personality. Please tell me you told her the gift was a mistake. A good steak pun is a rare medium well done. When I was 18, my boyfriend's mom got me an Elmo Live toy. I thought it was a gag gift, but it wasn't. My boyfriend got angry when I told him that no, I did not love it. I didn't say that to his mom though. She was genuinely a very sweet woman. My boyfriend got angry when I told him that no, I did not love it. This part is weirder than the gift itself. When I had my daughter, my grandmother arbitrarily decided that I was going to collect nutcrackers. Every year, she gives us a new one. So now I have 13 creepy 1.5 featuring tall wooden men of various types in my living room for the whole of December. I hate them and fully believe that one day they will rise up and murder me in my sleep. A hot pink sweater that was literally covered in sparkles with a little bow on it. I was 17 and had to pretend to like it so I didn't hurt my aunt's feelings, lol. When I was 12, I asked my mom for a pair of Converse. Instead of going for the basic ones, she got these checkered pink red blue ones that were just so horribly ugly. I pretended to like them but then asked my mom later if we could exchange them. We did. Although I still feel kind of bad. A few years ago, my in-laws handed out their gifts to my wife, me and my wife's sister and her then boyfriend. I opened my gift and it was a very large jar container of Cajun seasoning. It was like the size you would get at Costco. Seriously large. I was sort of confused because they gave their other daughter's boyfriend 3-4 t-shirts, a hat and a jacket from his favorite sports team, along with a gift card to a store he likes. And all they could come up with for me was a seriously huge jar of cooking seasoning. My father-in-law said he knew I liked to cook. I don't like to cook at all, and I got the impression they just forgot to buy me anything or couldn't be bothered to come up with anything better. I really don't mind getting a weird gift, or even no gift at all, but it hurts when it's so clearly obvious they didn't care enough to put even a modicum of thought into it, while at the same time see them buy such thoughtful gifts for their other daughter's boyfriend when I've been their son-in-law for 5 years at that point. I put the seasoning in their pantry before we left to go home. That really hammers home the way you were feeling at the time. Makes me sad just thinking about it. My dad gifted me his old phone when he upgraded. I guess it could have been an okay gift as I had an older phone that I wanted to upgrade, but I just wasn't in a hurry or prioritizing buying a new phone. But it was the same dang phone I had and his was more beat up than mine, lol. I was also 30 with the clear ability to upgrade if I wanted. My uncle gave me a hat once back in my low to mid-teens. It wasn't an awful hat, but certainly not one I would ever wear. I felt really bad laughing at it, thinking it was a gag gift, since it clearly made my uncle sad. He has only given me gift cards since. It was years ago, but it still makes me feel awful. My family always did the post office Christmas gift donation thing. You know, the one where you get a kid's age and gender to buy them gifts. Well, even on Social Security, my dad would give us the choice to do it, even if it meant us getting less. I loved it, always looked forward to it. My mom remarries and her new husband thinks it's a great idea to sign us up to receive gifts from the program. I never felt so ashamed. I felt so guilty, BC. I was taking someone's Christmas, I guess. I kept asking mom if we were gonna do it that year, and when she finally drives us to the post office, I got excited to pick out a name. She drives to the back and instead picks up 3 bags of presents. 3 for 2 kids. I was mortified. When I finally opened the presents, they acted like they got them for us. I couldn't be ungrateful, however, because the people who got me my presents went all out. A really warm coat and soft aft blanket. Art supplies. Really nice ones. That helped me get over myself, but I still felt crappy. A queen-sized top sheet, like for your bed. There was no fitted sheet to go with it and I did not have queen-sized bed. It could be awesome though. We have a king-size blanket for our queen-size bed, since my partner likes to burrito herself when she sleeps. So my family makes this our theme. Instead of Merry Christmas, we have Happy Crappy Christmas. Basically, instead of spending hundreds of dollars on gifts we don't know if the other person will like, we just buy dollar store and wish gifts that we are fairly certain the recipient will not like, but will laugh at the idea of it. Last year, I think my sister won when she bought us cheap Chinese anal bleaching kits. My dad's contribution to Christmas every year is to give everyone a cheap dollar store gun of some sort, ping pong ball gun, dart gun, etc. And we have a massive gunfight until they're all broken. Usually takes about an hour for every last one to break, but it's a pretty good tradition that costs next to nothing. My sister always buys me joke gifts. The coolest one was a Chinese bootleg Thomas the Tank Engine Voltron. The most WTF one was a gourd. My wife still receives a little kid's coloring book and crayons every year from her one grandpa and his wife for Christmas. She made the mistake of telling him that she liked to color when she was 8. When adult coloring books became a thing, I kind of got into it for stress relief. I made the mistake of telling people about it and ended up with like 6 coloring books one Christmas. The pages are so detailed, it takes at least an hour to do one. It may sound dumb, but I was so overwhelmed, I stopped coloring. A year ago, my mom got me a small, novelty size butter churn for Christmas. It's not pretty, not an art piece, and has no decorative value. The same year, she got my younger brother a Nintendo Switch and Breath of the Wild. One time, my aunt was on the wrong combination of medicines. Yes, she did eventually correct it, and she gave my brother and I gift bags that had a single clementine and 2 unsharpened pencils. Sounds close to what I get from one of my grandmas, but in her case it's because she has little income and likes to get gifts for most everyone. Every my cousins and I get a goodie bag from her for a holiday or something similar. We always get an unsharpened pencil, and at this point it's kinda just her thing now, so I like getting them. First Christmas my girlfriend, now wife, and I spent with my parents, opening gifts in my living room, and my mom gave me a vibrating dong ring as a stocking stuffer. Please say it was a gag gift. When I was 14 or 15, I told my mom that I really, really liked Andy's Mints. Every year since then I get Andy's Mints. I stopped being crazy about them when I was like 20 or so. I had a stack of several years boxes going until I finally made husband take it to work to give away. Similar with me, except marshmallow peeps. Every Easter is get showered in peeps from my mom even as a grown man. I freaking hate those things now. My brother bought me a body condom and labeled it to the biggest dong in the world. I got him a sweet clock that had backwards numbers and turned counterclockwise. We didn't really get along back then. Snowshovel from grandparents for my 13th birthday. They said I could use it to make dollar sign and buy whatever I wanted. They weren't wrong. I'm not at all religious, and once my father gave me a 18 inches tall statue of Jesus. I forgot it in a box in a storage room in his basement when I left. Well, excuse him for trying to sneak you into heaven. Last year I went through a pretty crappy breakup that kept being dragged through me and my ex being off and on for a while. I started to feel better around Christmas time, but still woke up Christmas morning and opened my stocking to find that Santa, my mum, had gifted me a mold your own boyfriend kit out of clay. Wasn't sure whether to laugh or cry. I did spend a nice evening molding an absolute stud though. My dad gave me an air compressor. It was the size of a mini fridge, about waist high, the kind you might have in your garage. Except I didn't have a garage, because I was living in an apartment, and I had nowhere to put it. I have moved since then, but I still don't have a garage or anywhere to put the thing. So it's sitting, unopened, in my friend's garage until I can find a better use for it. It might be time to sell it. Clowns. Every year a new clown. Try to tell my abuelito I don't like clowns. They are weird. Get a new clown figurine, doll, lamp, picture, or whatever every year for Christmas and birthday. I have boxes of clowns. Thankfully, sometime in my mid-20s my father managed to divert him to kittens. But that was only after 4 awkward years when he decided I loved cows. I don't love cows either. On the bright side, since I kept them all on my dresser growing up, I was never afraid of clowns. They're just background noise to me. I could probably walk into one in a dark alley and just be all oh, it's just one more dang clown. My mother tries to start new collections for family members that they do not want. She's trying so hard to make sure that we remember her when she's gone. It's like she's trying to conjure sentimentality. She also tries to give us new hobbies we don't want. My in-laws, parents and siblings all got me pajamas. The issue was when I opened the first set they said, since you sleep so much, WTF. My grandma decided it was a good idea to gift my sister and my cousin, also a girl, matching thongs last year for Christmas. The problem being that my cousin was 7 at the time. We still laugh about it when my grandma isn't around. Oh dear. My aunt gave me a banana case. Yeah, yellow plastic thing to put a banana and protect it from the world, I guess. The next year it was an apple case. You know, there's also an avocado case. For our first Christmas together, my boyfriend gave me this beautifully wrapped Christmas gift. I opened it in front of his entire family and it was the ugliest pair of shoes I have ever seen. Like grandmother slipper clogs. But the look on my face told everyone how I really felt, even though I said how much I liked them. They burst out laughing as it was a prank and my BF had another gift hiding. I got a similar unfashionable pair of slippers. Feet finally got so cold I said, frick it, I'll try them. They go with me everywhere and I ain't even mad at looks I get from guests coming over. Those mofas are the bomb. Even to this day, when my wife and I make pretty decent money, my grandma, 96 years old, still writes us a check for $15 each Christmas. It's very kind of her, but not as awesome to receive in your 30s as it was when I was 12. My grandma decides how much she wants to spend at Christmas and then divides that number by the number of cousins, which keeps growing since my southern cousins are baby machines. Last year my Christmas check was for $13.46. My mom once got me a calendar of photos of fast food, like, photos of hot dogs and cheeseburgers. She was like, well, you like food, so maybe if you get hungry you can just look at the calendar instead of eating. I got a pair of leggings with French fries on them so that I'd be able to enjoy fries without eating any. I feel your pain. A large box of condoms from my grandma because she overheard me and my ex going at it while she was visiting for the holidays and walked in on us in the heat of the moment. Thankfully the lights were off, but yeah, it was awkward and hilarious at the same time. Grandma's a bro. Be thankful for that woman and her concern for your willy. Got a seal clubbing nutcracker from a well-meaning family friend. They thought the seal was a pet and the guy was just petting it with his club. LOL. I want this. Quality. Quantity. I once had a girlfriend that gifted me like 12-15 items of clothing from Goodwill. Don't get me wrong. I have no problem with this in principle. For instance, trying to save money. But it just made no sense because 1. This girl did not hurt for money at all, and 2. Several of the items had stains or other damage. 3. By getting so many things, she spent more than she would have for one new item of clothing. Easily the worst gift I've ever received. It would be funny if she just gifted you all of the leftover clothes she had from previous relationships. Still a crap gift for sure. A jar of artichoke hearts. Apparently this family friend was around when I plucked one from a jar and ate it, because they're tasty, and I said something about liking them. So she got me a jar of artichoke hearts and nothing else. Everyone else got gift cards for Amazon from her that year, but I guess it was my turn for the gag gift. My husband has relatives who work in a thrift store, so the entire family gets some really weird presents from them. I got a used nightgown like what grandmas would wear. It was white, but had turned yellow from age. Smelled musty too. A stained incense stick holder, with some incense sticks in a package that was opened. A collection of china plates, with stains. A shirt so big, I could swim in it. A lightly used bottle of perfume that was pretty much odor mothballs. I just donate them right back to another thrift store. In 2006 for Christmas, I gave my then fiance a $450 hand-carved artist's easel. She gave me a 4-pack of Ferrero Rocher chocolates. My sister handed me my gift last Christmas and watched my face as I unwrapped it. It was a small painting of a butterfly and it was the ugliest thing ever, but she had painted it herself. I told her how cool it was and she let me squirm for a minute then laughed and said, "You dumb bee." That took me 10 minutes and it's ugly as heck. Then she handed me a gift card to one of my favorite places. I've had some amazing ones from my mother-in-law. A how to cook pasta book, a ceramic hen, one candle in a gift box that clearly originally had two candles in it, a pasta measurer shaped like a cowboy, and my absolute favorite, chocolate covered nuts. I am allergic to nuts and have an EpiPen. I've had 4 anaphylactic shocks in my life. My husband nearly had a heart attack when I opened them. She's trying to murder you with the hen. What's the most WTF thing you've seen go down in front of you? Two heavily pregnant women fighting. Like seriously fighting. I'm talking fists, kicks, scratching, hair pulling. Everybody wanted to break it up but nobody wanted to get in the middle of it. Maybe the babies inside of them were enemies in the past life and decided to continue their battle using their new mothers as flesh mecha Gundam. Driving home from work one night on the freeway, I look out my window to see a yellow motorcycle zip past me, on its side trailing sparks. The driver had fallen off and was rolling past my car. As I was watching him thinking, "Oh crap, he fell off. I hope he's okay." A black 4-door sedan rolls right over top of the guy, and that was the first time I ever had to call 911. One day at college during the spring semester, birds started falling out of the trees. Most couldn't fly, some were dead, others unconscious and kind of twitchy. Really freaked everyone out. Biology department investigates. They determined that a series of flash freezes kick-started the fermentation process of the new spring berries on the trees and the birds were getting crap-housed. There was some zoo I visited in Florida where the mulberry trees dropped a bunch of overripe berries and the monkeys in an enclosure ate tons of them and got drunk as frick. Saw two people having sex against the wall of the main train station wall at 6:30 p.m. on a Friday night. Cops pulled the guy out of her 5 minutes after I showed up. A very gruesome WTF. Once, back when I was a student, I was waiting for my train home to leave and as there were several minutes left, I was enjoying a sandwich outside on the platform. On the other side of the platform stood another train and a young couple was saying goodbyes and kissing and a man still stood in the door as the train started to leave. I took a bite of my sandwich. The man gave his girlfriend a last kiss and swung the door shut as he was jumping off. A piece of his jacket or perhaps trousers got caught up and he fell to the platform. Got dragged under the train and promptly crushed in a gruesome fashion with blood and other tissue spraying everywhere as his girlfriend stood and watched paralyzed in absolute horror. People in the train were banging at the windows and screaming for it to stop. People on the platform were in absolute panic and some of them had bits of the unfortunate guy on them. And I stood there with a half-chewed bite of my sandwich in my mouth and my jaws wide open in astonishment. I don't think I will ever see something as disturbing in my life happening so innocuously and within a few heartbeats, or chews. I was a kid, say around 7 maybe, My father and I are at the bank and he goes inside to do something and I stayed in the car. The driver's side door opens, and this guy gets in the car and looks down at the key. He finally turns and notices me, smiles and says, "Sorry, wrong car." I then see him get into a completely different style and color car just a few spaces down and drives away. As a kid, that scared the ever-loving bejesus out of me. Even as an adult, I'm terrified of someone stealing the car while I'm waiting in the passenger seat. Growing up, I worked on a passenger ferry to a town beach. One day we were on a layover between boats, sitting on the dock, eating lunch. It's quiet. There are ducks swimming by. Really nice sunny day. All of a sudden, a swan swoops in from God knows where and literally lands on top of one of the ducks, forcing it under the water. The swan is literally sitting on this duck as it struggles to get free. After a while, the struggling stops and the duck the swan landed on does not come back up to the surface. TLDR. I watched a swan drown a duck in cold blood. The ugly duckling still ugly on the inside. My husband and I were in a mall in Bethesda, Maryland when we passed a Tyson chicken kiosk where Mary Lou Retting was demonstrating how awesome Tyson chicken is. We watched for a moment and then walked on toward the mall exit. A short way down the mall we see a young woman escorting a person in a chicken costume toward the kiosk. The chicken appears to be splattered with blood red paint and they are carrying a bucket. They pass us and we stop. "Did you just see? Was that a chicken?" Not wanting to miss what was sure to be a spectacle, we turned around and followed the chick and her chicken friend to the Tyson chicken stage. The chicken costumed man runs toward the stage and tosses red liquid at Mary Lou Retting, who despite her Olympian status is unable to avoid it entirely. Security guards immediately rush the chicken and grab him while the woman screams about how Tyson murders chickens. As security drags the couple away, we hear the young woman shouting, "Stop choking the chicken. Stop choking the chicken." Still can't believe that happened. We had closed up the restaurant for the night and were cleaning up. Two women began knocking on the doors, asking us to let them in. They looked pretty distressed, so we let them in. They had been attacked on the street. We sat them down and rang the guardy. It was then we noticed the blood. One of the women had multiple puncture wounds in her back. She didn't even realize. They just felt the blow and assumed it was just punches, but whoever attacked them had stabbed them with a screwdriver or something. They were pretty upset but were remarkably calm considering they were full of holes. Pretty WTF moment for us in the restaurant. Shock and adrenaline can help you cope with anything, it seems. My life is pretty mundane but here goes thin. When I was in middle school, my family still had the big old box TV. In fact, its stand was an even bigger broken TV that was built into a wood frame and swiveled. So one day I had a open soda on top of the working top TV and accidentally moved the swivel, thus knocking the soda off. It did a full flip and landed right side up. Not a drop spilled. I proceeded to run outside and scream like a maniac. Probably the highlight of my life. This guy has seen some crap. I worked at a public shooting range for a number of years. One day back in 09, me and a few of the employees were unloading the rental guns from the safe to be put out on the firing line. Guy in front of me pulled out an Uzi and an SKS, both semi-auto. He broke the number one rule of gun safety and had them pointed up towards him. Long story short, he dropped the SKS and the bolt went into the trigger guard of the Uzi, which had the grip safety disabled, which was inexplicably loaded. It shot through his thumb, which was over the barrel, and right through his head. He fell to the floor, but didn't die until the helicopter ride on the way to the hospital. Man, I just don't get it when people take gun safety so casually. There's this older woman who goes to the same gym as I do, probably early 60s with bright blue pigtails. The only thing she does at the gym is stand in the middle of the weight room eating a papaya like a chipmunk every single day. This has been going on for years. When I was 12, my whole street was running garage sales on a Saturday morning. Towards one end, there were two sales next to each other, and one across the street. Everyone was out and about, including myself. I was surveying my spending options when out flies a deer from between two houses, darts across the street, and jumps right through the family room window of the house on the corner lot, shattered glass and all. From within the house I could see the deer bucking wildly and splattering blood all over white painted walls. The father commando rushes in and after 17 seconds of chaos, yelling and screaming, The deer struggles back out of the windows and limps away, bleeding a trail behind it. Commando Dad slowly comes back out the front door carrying his 6-year-old girl. She's pale white from shock and has her father's neck in a vice grip. She was the one screaming. The deer was later found dead 4 blocks away. Something similar happened to my aunt's friend. Deer busted in through the front window, then freaked out, spraying blood and breaking everything in the home, and then dying in a bedroom. The family had been on vacation and didn't get back till a few days later. Insurance wouldn't pay because they said they weren't coveted for mammal damage. In my middle school, a fight broke out between 2 girls. One of the girls yanked on the other girl's hair so hard, a patch of it came off and you could visibly see some blood leaking out of that area. The scream was something you don't forget. Cosmetologist here. I've seen girls who've been hair snatched. In some cases, if the patch of scalp doesn't heal properly, you might never grow hair in that spot again. Even just 1 square inch of hair takes quite a bit of force to pull out in one go. It's super vanilla, but one time I drove by a topless, obese man taking a kitten out of a mailbox. That was like 5 years ago, and I still wonder about the context. Finally, I got some pee. Just a few days ago, dolphins in the river. I thought I went crazy, but then I saw them 5 more times over the next 30 minutes. I am still searching in the web whether it is possible. Is it? River dolphins are a thing. Google it. I was in my car, turning around to get into a parking space when I see that the space I wanted was occupied by a woman sitting on the curb taking a crap. Needless to say, I parked elsewhere. Was walking in central London to uni about 6 years ago. Just me and 2 guys ahead of me on their bikes on the pavement chatting. They looked very normal. A city police van drives past me and stops at the traffic light. Suddenly about 5 officers burst out the back with machine guns. Rare sight in UK. Grab these 2 guys, guns in their faces, and drags them into the vans. Sirens on, and off they go. Biggest WTF is why I didn't take the 2 free bikes. I saw a lady I refer to as the bird lady in the metro station in Shanghai, China. She was putting sausage into her mouth, chewing it up so it was in small pieces and salivary, and then spitting it into the waiting mouth of her granddaughter, who had her mouth open and waiting, like a little bird. It was gross and I still remember it, 4 years later. My first day in Seattle, way back in the summer of 99. I saw a hipster on Capitol Hill in unzipped skinny jeans walking his dog with a leash handle around his frank and beans. Welcome to Seattle, where you can see at least one seriously WTF moment every single day without trying. Riding the train on my way home from work one Friday night and a small group of college students comes on, clearly already pre-gaming at like 6 p.m. They're talking and being loud, and I notice that one girl has some stuff leaking out of the little drawstring bag she's bringing with her. I think to myself, dang, that's going to suck when she finds out. Not a moment later, she turns to her friends and says, "Hey guys, I just peed." Ha, and without missing a beat, they all just laugh and one guy goes, "Oh, Brittany," and they all just get off the train as the doors open. Still laughing and being kids while the rest of us commuters are just staring dumbfounded at this puddle of pee on the floor now. A monkey once jumped onto my lap. I was in a car in Asia and stretched out its hand. I gave it $1 and it ran away and gave it to its master, who was waiting nearby. Walking through a forest path at my university, I saw 2 crows taking on a snake. I watched for like 5 minutes as the birds were trying to peck at the snake and the snake was picking which bird to lunge at. It seemed like the birds were going for the snake's eyes. It felt like that scene in Chamber of Secrets where Fox takes out the basilisk's eyes. Drive by on a neighbor's house, in the middle of the day, in apartments, while we had a party and a bouncy house out front full of kids. The kids will be totally safe in the bouncy house. The bullets will just bounce off of it. I was with a friend, passing by a bar terrace, when one guy stepped in front of us, dropped down to his knee, and proposed to me. He actually had an engagement ring and held it out. His friends kinda gathered around and cheered on. I just laughed and walked around him. Be sure to carry around a positive pregnancy test for the next time this happens so you can pull it out and tell him you dreamed this would happen, because your little family will soon be 3. Last summer, Some friends and I decided to go drop acid down at the lake near where we lived. We found a comfortable, private spot to set up camp and began our trip. About 3-4 hours in, we start swimming around, tripping our balls off as we play in the water and watch the clouds go crazy. Then we hear some noise and look over to see a fat, shirtless redneck in Jean shorts and his wrinkly, way too tan wife steering a small boat towards the shore near us. We start to get a little worried as they get nearer and nearer, not sure how we are gonna play it cool with them that close to us. Then, all of a sudden, we see a little whiner dog hop off the boat, followed by another, and another, until there eventually are 7 little whiner dogs running around the shore right in front of us. After what was probably 30 minutes to an hour, the man whistled and they all ran back to the boat and hopped on, sailing into the sunset never to be seen again. It was a very strange occurrence, and I wouldn't have believed it was real if my friends hadn't seen it as well. Sitting at a cafeteria late at night in my shady neighborhood, a BMW drives up the parking lot and a man gets out and walks away. BMWs are not something you leave unattended there, so it was already a bit weird, but whatever, I have food. A few minutes later, another guy walks up to the car looking around suspiciously. He grabs the freaking keys from behind the front wheel somewhere, gets in and drives off. I've no idea what kind of deal this was, but if you get the freaking BMW for free with it, then I haven't seen crap. Probably getaway car exchange or payment to a bookie. At my university, I watched an eagle, which aren't common in my area, swoop down and kill a squirrel early in the morning. My friend nearly shot me in the face when I was 15. I showed him my brother's SIG 9mm with hollow point bullets, then took the clip out and handed it to my friend. He proceeded to point blank aim the gun at me and pull the trigger. One in the chamber, literally put a small cut in the shoulder of my shirt. WTF brother, why is one in the chamber? WTF friend, it's a gun. Don't point and shoot unless you plan to kill. WTF myself, not checking the chamber. You know your brother is an idiot. I was driving through town one evening and I stopped at a stop sign. I look out my window and see a kid, 10 years old or so, dressed up like a banana. We make eye contact and he starts dancing. WTF. I was visiting my girlfriend's university to see a dude strip down to his birthday suit and play a song on his guitar for who appeared to be his ex-girlfriend. I was on vacation this past year to the Dominican Republic and for some reason our rental had issues when turning the car on, the alarm would go off and not shut off. Eventually we learned to deal with it and just drive until it shut off. So one day we are driving with the alarm on and one of their army men pull us over. We anticipate him coming up to us to say something about the alarm. Instead he starts chasing down a Haitian selling fruit. The Haitian tries to run and the army man shoots him with his M16. I shitted myself at that moment. I was in Iraq and we had stopped to address a civilian vehicle that had blown up in the middle of Fallujah. It was an insurgent planting an IED and he made a mistake. Anyway, we had traffic stopped with about 500 meters between them and us for about 15 minutes. Then all of a sudden, a van starts pulling forward. Initially, we didn't have an aggressive posture. We started waving him off, putting my hand up with my palm facing him, a universal indication of stop. He doesn't. As he continues to move forward, at a slow but steady pace, about 10 of us take more aggressive postures. I took a knee, bringing my weapon to alert. This does not faze him. He continues to approach. There is a very real threat of VBIEDs, vehicle-borne improvised explosive devices, and as this posturing has not slowed his approach, we move to the ready, weapons aimed in. Still, he continues. We had no choice but to open fire when he was 150-200 meters away. The vehicle comes to a halt. We cease fire. The man is ordered out of the vehicle from a distance. He is miraculously unscathed, unbeknownst to any of us. There was an 11-year-old passenger, his son, in the front seat. He was also physically unscathed. An interpreter asked him why he didn't stop and he said he was tired of waiting. I mean, how stupid do you have to be? What was his though process like? Man, this is taking forever. I'm just going to move up and go around them. Oh, they're waving at me. Ha, I'll keep going. Man, they are starting to look like a bunch of pee off hornets being poked with a stick. I wonder what's bothering them. I'll keep steady. Hola fucking shit la placesavim. I mean, seriously. WTF, you have your kid in the car with you. TLDR, told Iraqi to stop, ignored us, shot up vehicle, he and his son survived. It happened when I was 12. On my way home, a strange guy, probably 16 or 17, appeared in front of me. I was scared AF, because he looked very brutal. He then came directly towards me and kissed my cheek, followed by the words God loves you. He then proceeded to run away, laughing like crazy. I nearly crap my pants, but it was worth it. He was tripping, I guarantee it. I was at a party with some mates, and of course beer pong starts going down. Now one of my mates was so drunk out of his mind he could barely stand up, let alone get anything in. Adding to this, he was the worst at any sport you could think of, but somehow in his drunken state he was getting every single ping pong ball in the cups. He must have had an 80% accuracy rate or something ridiculous. He remembers none of it. He was so drunk he forgot he was crap at sports. I don't know if it's the most WTF thing, but it did just happen. I'm driving along. I see a car ram into the back of a black SUV. SUV pulls over. The car stops. Three angry, obese Asian men jump out of the SUV carrying tire irons and a baseball bat and literally jump on the car, battering the crap out of it, breaking the windshield, etc. One of them breaks the passenger's window and tries to drag the driver out. Driver backs up at speed, fat Asians tumbling everywhere, puts it into drive to ram the car again. Fat Asians are running into the SUV now while the car dude backs up, rams them, backs up, rams them. Fat Asian SUV speeds away, weaving through traffic, followed by broken windshield jacked up sedan guy, music still blasting from the speakers. A stray dog pulling a pizza out of the trash, and a big rat coming up and stealing it from him. The dog didn't even try and take it back. I was walking in St. Petersburg, Russia while studying abroad. We were in a shopping residential area off of Nevsky Prospect when a police car shows up. Now this wasn't an area where cars normally went, so it was strange. Then four guys get out of the car, open the trunk and put on FSB bulletproof vests and small arms. They looked like submachine guns, but I wasn't close enough to tell. They then proceed to walk into an apartment building. I told our group we had to get the frick out of there. Gonna repost from one of a previous thread. Strap in, ladies and gentlemen, we're in for a ride. I lived in a lot of shady areas in my youth. Let's start with Dominican Republic. 1. There was this one time we were driving down a very lonely highway. The light power was gone and it was pouring rain. Where out of nowhere a man was sitting in the middle of the street. We barely had time to react, much less brake. He jumps up, but it's too late. Beck thing I know, he is on our roof and off the back of the car. Windows broken, and on the side of the road we jump out and cars are zooming by his motionless body. He is not dead, but blood is coming from everywhere. We lift him and his knees fold the wrong way. He place him on the side of the road, cops arrest us. But we are released once they find out we were not at fault and he was freaking pee drunk. We went to the hospital next day. He was alive but will never walk again. The pain he and his family were feeling will make this a vivid experience I never want to see again. Tough times. 2. Dom rep still. Guy ahead of us gets bones in an intersection. He nonchalantly steps out of his car and shoots 6 shots into the other person, then sits on that guy's hood. It seemed like 5 minutes before my cousin hightails it out of there. He seemed defeated. He killed the other guy cold blood over bull. Before you get pissy, there isn't a proper 911. But we tried calling. 3. Dominican Republic once again. Who were driving in a major highway or a small caravan because we were going to the beach. And it's not uncommon for people to cross major highways, even jumping the median. There's a group of people who were crossing. And out of nowhere a semi-truck steamrolled right past us and hits a few of them. Thing in the world can prepare you for that imagery. Life becomes death in a matter of a nanosecond. The highway was covered in human remains. I could barely look. We all just mutually pulled up a few miles up the road and sat there in silence for what seemed hours. To this day it's the worst thing I've ever seen. 4. A car running from the police runs a red light and rams a minivan. The van was hit so hard it flips over. The scramble to jump out of the car and running to the car. Even a group of 10 men couldn't flip it to access the kids. The screams and the cries until the fire crew got there was terrible. One child didn't make it. As a father now, I cannot imagine that feeling of helplessness while you watch a child slip away. 5. USA. NJ. Drug dealer that worked the corner near my house. First drive-by I've ever seen. The screams were terror-inducing. I've seen some crap, man. That's nothing compared to the guy that watched an open soda can fall off of the top of his TV and do a full flip, landing right side up without spilling a drop. I'm sure I have a lot of other stories, but this immediately comes to mind. I was smoking a blunt with a couple girlfriends on top of one of the mountains in my area. It's a pretty secluded place, but most people know of it as a good smoke spot or hiking place. Well, we were just finishing up and about to go to our car, when a black Lincoln Town Car with NY license plates pulls up. Weird, but okay. A man steps out of the driver's seat wearing a suit and opens the back door. Then, two men step out of the back seat in the freshest black suits I have ever seen. They both have dark skin, look Italian. They put their hands in their pockets and just stare at my friends and I. Mind you, we were high as frick, but we all realized in that moment we were no longer welcome there. We fumbled for the keys and got the frick out of there. I don't know what they were doing up there, but to this day, my friends and I think they were dumping a body. In my sophomore year at university, I was smoking a cigarette and drinking my morning coffee on the front porch of my apartment-style dorm. Across the street there was a non-dorm apartment building that had a front lawn with a single oak tree in front of it. By that oak tree a squirrel was doing squirrel things, and I was taking enjoyment in watching the squirrel doing squirrel things on a perfect spring morning in Pittsburgh. Then it stopped. The squirrel stopped and stared at me. Its black little eyes burned into the very core of my soul. Without warning, a peregrine falcon comes out of a nosedive and crushes my furry little friend into the dirt. Now the falcon is standing on the squirrel, staring at me. I am awestruck by its power and majesty. I look around to see if there were other witnesses to this strange happening. There is a small Indian man struggling up the walkway to the apartment building with two overstuffed sacks of groceries. The falcon decides to take his meal to go and is taking off squirrel in talons, and smacks the man in the head with a dead squirrel. The man falls over and drops the groceries. The bags break. The man throws an orange at the bird. He misses. He screams profanity while I stand in bewildered, amazed silence and finish my cigarette. First off, we were both completely broke. I mean rolling pennies for cigarettes broke. I mean waiting all day for the frickin' beer truck to show up at the store across the street so we can sprint over and swipe a case of beer kinda broke. Anyway, he, my cousin, calls me up and asks if I'd go with him to a house party in the next town over. Sure. So we get there and it's a house full of people in their mid-20s. We were about 16 at the time. I tell him that I don't know anyone here and ask him who invited him. He says, "Be cool, bro. I got this." You got what I asked, but he dipped into the bathroom. That's when I saw the table. In the middle of the crowd was a dining room table covered in baggies of coke and weed. So I'm sitting there by myself in a crowd of drunk strangers who are at any minute gonna ask who the frick I am. When my cousin returns from the bathroom. "Dude, we gotta get the frick out of here," I say under the din of howling, music, and laughter. "Just relax and wait for it," he says. That's when we heard someone yell "cops." The whole crowd turned into a stampede. People were flying down hallways, crawling out windows. I start to run, lose sight of my cousin. I make it out the back door and I'm running as fast as I can through the backyard. Glance over my shoulder and I can see four police cruisers with gumballs blazing right in front of the house. I make it to the tree line and look back. I can see my cousin still clearing the yard carrying something in a curtain. He catches up and through heavy breaths makes out, "Dude, I got it all." He opened the sack and showed me that it was full of coke and weed. In the panic he had ripped down a curtain and filled it with everything on the table. I rejoiced at the sight of it. What a spectacle to behold. We wasted no time in getting the frick out of there. We made it to some railroad tracks and decided to follow them. While walking I mentioned to him, "Dude, I can't believe in that surprise panic you had the sense of mind to grab the crap." To which he says, "What surprise panic? Dude, I'm the one who called the cops." Your cousin freaking rules. People who have traveled to China, what is your WTF China story? I am a very normal looking female American. Dirty blonde hair, blue eyes, 5'5", When I was in Beijing, people kept walking up behind me and then their friend would take a picture of us. At first I was like, what the frick is going on? Then I finally got someone to tell me that a lot of Beijing tourists are people from the country making a big trip to the city and have never seen a white person in real life. So after that, when someone would try to sneak up behind me, I would just smile and use some sort of sign language to say, let's just take the picture together. So there are about 20 random Chinese country people with pictures of me like we are best friends at random spots around Beijing. A friend of mine has a long gray beard and is quite round in the belly region. He gets stopped every couple minutes in busy places, since he looks like Santa Claus apparently. A little girl even dragged him home in the Hutongs and excitedly told her parents that she found Santa. They were totally embarrassed and tried to apologize 100 times. Our translator had a good laugh. Not me, but my brother. He was invited to a wedding out in rural China, and due to his white skin became more important than the bride. He literally lived the rural life. Constant photos because people not from main cities literally have never seen white people before. My brother spoke only English at the time, so communication was merely by charades. But there is one story that is my absolute favorite. Due to being out in rural China, if you want a shower you have to go to the public showers. First time he went, it was just the guys from the Chinese family he was staying with. Next time, it was essentially every male who lived nearby. They were fascinated. My brother is usually super shy, but he figured he was in the middle of nowhere, so he was cool with all these Chinese males checking him out. But that's not the best part. Oh no, not yet. If anyone has seen that Conan video where he and Steven Yeun go to a Korean bathhouse, you would be aware of how great these bathhouses can be. Well, there was a concrete slab in the middle of the shower, which the owner started getting wet and scrubbing. My brother ignored it, too busy being side-eyed by Asian men. But then the owner grunted at him and started pointing at the slab, using limited communication to tell him to get on the slab. So my brother, naked as the day he was born, the only white guy for miles, usually so shy and self-conscious, climbed on and proceeded to be scrubbed by some old Chinese man, while a large audience watched in awe. Thanks for the what and also awesome. Went to a mall in Wuxi, and at the top and bottom of all the escalators were these meme faces: Obama, Jackie Chan, various rage cartoons, and Chinese words. My GF informed me that these were signs to watch your step getting on off the escalators, as apparently, lots of people get sucked in and I wish they died. WTF. LOL. There was a bit of news in China around this time last year too about those steps and some poor suckers getting pulled under. You'd go around and see people jumping over the platforms. Definitely bit of a WTF moment. We got enough food to have a filling breakfast for 4 adults with plenty left over for 10 yuan, or $1.67. I ate an entire pigeon, including its brain. I had cow lung, brain, heart, kidney. Weirdest dish I think was frog stir fry. This wasn't frog legs. This was just frogs cut in half and stir fried with a lot of Szechuan seasoning. I also had silkworm cocoons. Just living silkworms in the process of metamorphosis that you fry in some sesame oil. They tasted like pre-buttered lobster, honestly. To answer the question, the sheer variety of meats was my WTF China moment. A few things from my trip. Got all the high fives. I'm a 6-foot-tall white guy with super blue eyes. Don't think they see too many of us. Ate a fried bee. Taiwan. Seriously tasted like chicken though it was chewy and dry. I could not see the sky in Beijing due to the smog. It was disgusting. McDonald's delivery scooter. The slide down the Great Wall. The best. Finally, as I was getting off the plane in Beijing, a man a few rows back asked me if this was my first time here and why I was visiting. I told him it was my first time visiting and I was here on vacation. He seemed so happy and excited that I was visiting his country. Made me feel really great about the trip and excited to see it. Not a WTF moment, but it was pleasantly unexpected. I lived in China last year and have had a few of those moments. For background before I begin, I am a 6 feet 6 inches white American with a generally Nordic appearance who speaks Mandarin at an intermediate level. At English Corner, native speakers are a sought-after commodity, so I tended to attract a large group who wanted to practice their English with me. Once there was a young woman who entered the group and one of the first things she says to me is, "I like your nose. You have a very appealing nose." Immediately after which she asks, "Do you have a Chinese girlfriend?" I say that I do not. To which she replies, "Do you want one?" In Chengdu, as well as almost any major city in China, there are signs in various places listing the core virtues of communism. This would be much more effective if Chengdu was no home to some of the world's largest shopping malls. No one expects foreigners to understand any Mandarin. Because of this, people will often yell, "We're gathering," which means foreigner, without expecting you to understand. People, mostly younger, will run up to you and say hello or some other simple phrase in English and often giggle and run away when you respond. You will see fairly unusual cuts of meat, including, but not limited to, duck tongue, full chicken head, cow intestine, and pig brain. I have a few others, but these were the first to come to mind. Feel free to ask for more. My friend told me a story about his hometown. They're a smaller city that wanted to show some sophistication by introducing pigeons to their city ecosystem. A very European flair. So they imported a bunch of pigeons and set them loose. Unfortunately, not a month later, the city stopped their initiative in shame because the locals managed to capture and eat all of the pigeons they had tried to introduce. I've lived in the expat community in China for about 16 years. 10 or so years ago, one of my mom's Scandinavian friends was talking on the phone in her native language. After the person on the other end hung up, they heard a Chinese person on the phone saying, "Next time, please speak English or Chinese." Everyone thought my 14-year-old son was Daniel Radcliffe, even though he was 5 feet 9 inches with very curly hair. This was when one of the Deathly Hallows movies was playing in Shanghai, and there were posters and stuff up in a lot of places. Every so often, people would walk up to him, point and yell "Harry Potter." They might have just thought he was Darren Criss. I traveled to China last year with my partner, who was teaching in Beijing. We decided we wanted to ride camels in the Gobi Desert because of reasons. Getting to Mongolia was way too expensive and a hassle for our time schedule, so we ended up taking an overnight train to Zhongli, which is just up against the desert. Lonely Planet recommended one guy, Billy freaking Billy, in the guidebook for this camel excursion. So we hire Billy. He drives us out to this random place and a local farmer walks up with 3 camels for our overnight trek into the desert. Billy hands the farmer some cash. Not nearly enough, we think. And we get on the camels and go with this guy who speaks no English and probably speaks a dialect of Mandarin. Anyway, off we go. It's hot. It's full of dunes. It's cool as frick. Billy has warned us that dinner will be simple. Backcountry fare. Billy is not with us. By the way, freaking Billy, no problem. We backpack a lot. We can dig it. We stop for camp and the guy builds a fire and puts white rice in a pan. We watch, waiting for the salt, the pepper, the veggies, the something. But nope. We got served plain white rice for dinner, and some apples that tasted like soap, and this weird pickled thing that tasted like goodness knows. We're not picky eaters. We are adventurous eaters. But this was the worst. We also got these weird processed meat sticks that looked, smelled, and I guess tasted like dog food. Freaking Billy had given us beer, though, and that probably had more nutritional value than the white rice. So we drank that. The next day, we had ramen for breakfast. Would have been better for all the meals, and trekked back to the town. I swear Billy was keeping his overhead like zero. He was profiting off of being a Chinese guy who spoke English and who somehow got Lonely Planet. And don't even get me started on those guys and their terrible advice in China. To list him in his book, I think he paid the farmer a pittance of the $300 or so we paid him. We tipped the farmer generously before Billy picked us up, and Billy probably paid next to nothing for the rice. So that's the story of how we got ripped off by freaking Billy in China. But on that same trip, When we were hanging out in Zhongwei one evening, as the only Westerners, and an interracial couple at that, we were sitting having dinner, and a group of women out for a girls' night paid for our dinner and insisted on taking us for karaoke. They spoke no English and got a young kid who spoke English to ask us. We played Chinese drinking games, sang in English while they sang in Mandarin, and had the best freaking time. China can be WTF in all the worst and best ways. I have lived in China for 13 years. Mine would have to be when we had to give up our home to a Chinese crime lord. We were renting a home in Shanghai. It was worth about $15 million. Not that we could ever buy it, but rent wasn't too bad. Anyways, our landlady was this great and ambitious woman who had built herself up as a pretty successful landowner in China. Unfortunately, as per Chinese tradition, she had to be married and her husband was an absolute deadbeat. He spent all his time gambling illegally. He eventually racked up a debt of over 10 million RMB, over 1 million US dollars, and borrowed money from the Chinese mob to pay it off. A smart move on the mob's part, because they were probably the ones running the gambling in the first place and knew this guy owned a lot of property through his wife. Anyways, one day out of the blue, our landlord tells us, with some muscle behind her, probably to prompt her rather than scare her as she looked pretty disheveled, that we have 24 hours to move. The mob had shown up demanding their money, and when she did have it, agreed to take the house instead. A pretty good profit for them if you ask me. We talked to the mob guys and explained that we didn't have anything to do with this and asked if we could have more time. They were pretty nice about it and understood, and after calling what must have been their HQ, they agreed to give us 4 days. The next day, the mob boss showed up to look around our house to see what he had acquired. He was a tall but average looking Chinese man in his late 40s to mid 50s, wearing a long brown leather coat. He had 4 shorter but far more muscular armed bodyguards who were dressed entirely in black. And his wife was there wearing a red dress. She was insanely beautiful. A solid 10, uniquely tall for an Asian woman as well. He was very friendly and shook all our hands, apologizing for inconveniencing us. He was the only one that spoke. His bodyguards just watched us all very carefully, and his wife smiled but didn't comment. It was pretty surreal. He looked so normal but definitely had a pretty intimidating aura about him, mostly in the way he walked and talked, like he literally owned the place. Well, actually at this point he did have her. Anyways, he liked the house, thanked us in nearly perfect English for giving him a tour and our hospitality, and left. 3 days later we had moved out. We kept in touch with our landlady, but her husband disappeared. It was pretty heavily implied that he had gone into hiding but been caught and killed. So that was interesting. I have a ton of stories from China, but that was one of the more memorable ones. I went when I was little, about 5 or 6, and I barely remember it, but apparently everywhere I went, crowds would surround me and touch my head. Apparently touching blonde hair was good luck or something. First time in Beijing in 2010, I went to a restaurant with a local. She invited me, so I didn't check whether I had enough cash. The place was huge and looked fairly classy, not a small family-run place in a hutong. So when we finished and the bill came, it was about 350 RMB if I recall correctly, and apparently the girl had only like 180. I was like, shit, what's gonna happen now? But she kept completely calm, going like, I'm well done, which didn't make me feel any better. She tried to call a friend she knew lived somewhat close to the restaurant but couldn't reach her. I could throw in about 50, but that was about it. So she talked to the waitress for a while, gave her all we had, and then we left. I was so confused. I asked what happened, and the girl told me she could just bring the rest of the money another day. I was completely stunned. Usually China is very competitive. People try to rip you off if you don't pay close attention in many places. And here we were, getting away like this. The best part was when I asked her if the waitress wrote down her name and address or something, and she said yeah, she got my last name. Like, just the last name. In a country where I feel like there are only about 10 surnames and they all sound like Gong, Dong, Li, Zhang. I'm sorry there isn't a more dramatic story, but this just felt so out of place that it's somehow the first thing that comes to mind. 350 RMB, so about 56 US dollars. There was a beggar near the Shanghai waterfront that looked so deformed and scary. One of my fellow travelers cried. He looked like he had been in a chemical accident of some sort, wherein his skin and bones melted into this deformed blob of weird proportions. Worst part was he had a smile on his face permanently. There was also the lady that shoved me and cut in line at McDonald's. I was kinda taken aback because she was so rude. My tour guide told me Chinese people hate Americans. A positive WTF moment. The Tomb of the Terracotta Soldiers. I have never seen something so magnificent in its scope before. This emperor had thousands of soldiers and horses made of terracotta to be buried with him in his tomb for the afterlife. It was found by a farmer when he found a piece of terracotta. They are still excavating the site. Seriously, WTF, Qin Shi Huang. It's weird that he built all those soldiers but didn't have his burial site marked well enough for people to know not to farm there. Being living in China for 2 years now. So many weird stories about this country. People skipping in line in front of a blind man taking advantage of him and his handicap. All the hawkers packing up and disappearing in less than a minute when hearing the police coming. Nearly getting hit weekly by all types of vehicle because people just cannot respect street signs and robots. Shanghai subway madness. Sitting in a club all night with your $300 champagne bottle in front of you and doing nothing but watching people dance and smoke. The way they look at foreigners. So much racism against black guys. There is just so many WTF moments that you don't get as shocked at the end of the day. Those are bad habits that a lot of the older generations have. The young people are a lot different than their peers, emo. Sorry for bad formatting. I am on my phone and sorry for the bad English, not my mother tongue. Once my hosts took us to a fine dining establishment. Bill for four of us, factory wage for 2 months. The intro course was some sort of fermented fish head soup that smelled exactly like crap. You could put a bullet into my head and I wasn't going to put something that smelled that bad in my mouth. The multiple times I saw kids crapping on the sidewalk through their crotchless pants. Most babies have crotchless pants instead of diapers. Also the time in Shanghai where a random family came up to my girlfriend and just inserted their baby into her arms and gathered around to take family pictures with her as she held their baby, without even saying a word to her first. Good God, I could go on and on. I'm Chinese and lived in China for 3 years. This is my time to shine. One time I went to an alligator theme park. There were lots of exhibits showing different kinds of crocodiles, alligators, caimans, etc. The reserve had a lot of alligators. How do you get rid of extra alligators? On the way out we passed by a restaurant and they were making alligator dumplings. I crap you not. They had a huge window where you could look in and see the cooks preparing the alligator meat. I looked in and saw giant severed alligator heads lying on the counter. No biggie. A mother letting her baby take a dump in public. In the middle of an IKEA. This isn't exactly abnormal. Street food. Vendors sold scorpion skewers in a Beijing tourist hotspot. The scorpions were pretty small and tied to the skewers, and still alive. You pointed to a skewer you wanted and the vendor would fry them right in front of you. The same store also sold pupae skewers, seahorse on a stick, and starfish on a stick. I've eaten so much weird crap in China. The freaking Chengdu Panda Reserve and how much unnecessary care goes into maintaining their pandas. The reserve is right in the middle of their natural habitat and yet they have to bring the pandas in every afternoon because they're afraid the pandas would get heat stroke. If you're really pale skinned, have really blonde hair, a lot of people will go up to you and ask to take photographs. I knew an American kid who charged people 5 yuan to take a photo with his sister who had bright ginger hair. People paid him. Oh yeah, and a few years ago when I was living in Shanghai, the river that bisects the city was suddenly filled with bloated pig corpses floating down the river. Apparently some farmers upstream had lost a bunch of pigs to some weird disease, so they did the logical thing and dumped them in the river. Despite all the weirdness, I loved living in China. I've got a ton more stories if anyone is interested. I was watching a children's game show in China and when the child won the Final Fantasy I Victory theme played. That was on state-run TV. Furthermore. One story I have when I was in China was outside a tourist attraction. A woman dressed in a uniform was standing by the entrance telling all the cars that were passing by that you needed to pay money to go to a big part of the attraction. However, that part of the attraction was actually free and the woman wasn't an employee of the attraction at all. She was just a random person who was misinforming people and collecting free money. She was taking advantage of some tourists' lack of knowledge of the attraction. Tour buses and tour guides who knew the attraction was free would just go right past her. I've traveled to China a bit and usually go with the flow okay. A few experiences stand out. Going to a dinosaur-themed water park with thousands of families all around and English. Very explicit, gangster rap music blaring throughout the park. A roadside stand near my apartment that only sold animal feet on a stick. Learning to stand back against the wall on the subway after an erection was jammed between my butt cheeks on my commute. A young hospital intern filming my naked upper body during treatment. Eating horse. Eating donkey. Eating fish brains. Not getting sick food poisoning while eating anywhere and everywhere, except that one time from bottled water. 8 major brands had E. coli contamination. My wallet fell out of my bag in a taxi. The company made the employee return from home, after hours, go to the garage, look for the wallet. Then he drove to me and returned it. I got a few things. People do not stop their cars when you're crossing the street, they'll just blast their horn. Letting you know they're coming but they won't stop. If you hesitate they'll hit you. So I just closed my eyes and crossed. While horns were blaring, we got mugged by a massive pack of monkeys on MT. We hit them before they could steal our bags with all our stuff. But the other group of people weren't lucky. Phones, wallet, etc. were gone. People being very disrespectful in temples and historical sites. Crapping and pee in the streets and touching knocking stuff. Lots of police. Like they just have squads patrolling around. How people who don't own shoes have smartphones. How rude in general people were most of the times. Like when we were hiking in narrow paths or steep stairs they'd shove you. People wearing heels while hiking. People taking pics of me in the streets. How 80% of the TV there were drama shows about the China-Japan feud. The socially accepted racism. The northerners are awful. They just steal phones and sell skewers but the Japan hate is pretty real. And towards blacks a lot too from what I heard. Still, place is 10/10 in my book and I can't wait to have more money to afford another trip. For all its faults, I love the place and its culture. Serious, nosy parents of Reddit. What's the most messed up thing you discovered snooping through your kid's bedroom? When my son was 6 years old, I went into his room and found a live pigeon that he had been keeping as a pet. He was really sad when I let it outside. That rules. When my son was 3 I found an old banana peel in a clipboard that opened. We were battling a fruit fly infestation and couldn't figure out what they were after. It was so disgusting when I opened that thing and hundreds of fruit flies flew out. My brother left a banana and a container of food in his backpack all summer. He finally cleaned it out and it was crawling with maggots, and something else flew out that he was never able to find. It was horrifying. My daughter went through a phase when she was around 6-8 where she only ever put dirty tissues under her bed. I would regularly be on hands and knees sweeping boxes worth of tissues out from under there while going, "Why are you doing this? We have a bin." Thankfully she's past that. Sounds like me when I'm sick. Trash can is too far. The floor is good enough. My parents actually found beer cans under my brother's pillow. His defense, he'd found the discarded can in the yard and picked it up planning on throwing it away. He maintains that as truth, even 18 years later. Our kids share a small bedroom so there isn't many places to hide stuff. They're young. 4 and 6. We don't let them have much candy or sugary treats. A few times a week they will have some cookies or something but not every day. So one day my wife is in there cleaning and she pulled one of their beds away from the wall to vacuum and found our eldest daughter's stash of candy. She had all kinds there. Kit Kats, Twix, packets of potato chips. It was all unopened except for some bags of hard candy. We were both quite surprised because we keep the candy out of their reach in high cupboards in our kitchen. So how exactly did she amass such a collection of delicious contraband? Well, it turned out she would take her candy when given it by us and sometimes save it. She would never refuse a treat even if she didn't particularly want it because she might want it later and so stashed it behind her bed in the gap against the wall. I found it quite interesting that she could have such forward thinking to know she would maybe want some candy later and needed to secure her supply now. So anyway, we let her keep the candy but we put it in a bowl on her dresser and we explained to her she didn't need to eat it all. She could continue to keep it there for when she wants some candy. Neither of them have eaten that stash. Just a few pieces. So I guess it worked out pretty good. When I was 12 and in 6th grade, I got in trouble for basically just goofing off and being poorly behaved in class at school. The teacher made me write a note to my parents telling them what I had done, and she signed it and I signed it, and I was instructed to give it to my parents. I did bring it home but realized that my parents didn't know to be looking for it, so I decided to hide it, because I feared it would be found in the trash. So I unscrewed the cover of the air conditioner vent and placed the note in there, figuring in an emergency I could go back and get it if the teacher ever somehow asked about it. Fast forward like 15 years later or so, and my parents are having the air conditioning in the house replaced and also having the ducts cleaned in the process. Worker finds the now forgotten note and gives to my parents. I get a call, was living in an apartment in college at the time, that I needed to come home because we had to have a talk. Came home to serious parents who sat me down at the kitchen table to discuss the problems I'm having at school. I was beyond confused and so lost as to what they were talking about. They then bring out the now ancient note and we all had a good laugh about it. It was funny. Not snooping through his room, but stuff he was throwing out, I found my son's journal from when he was about 9. In it, he chronicles how he heard me and my then boyfriend have sex on multiple occasions. I probably died of embarrassment reading it. Bahaha, I wrote that in my journal once, complete with quotes from the whole ordeal. Really cringy things were screamed. Thin walls. I don't snoop, so I haven't stumbled across anything too crazy, but when my kids were in 3rd and 4th grade I found a shoebox, without the top, filled with actual cash and Jesus dollars when I grabbed their hamper to do laundry. Jesus dollars were something my kids' school gave out to kids for good behavior or high scores or doing anything Jesus-like. My daughter was a top student and collected a lot of Jesus dollars. They were allowed to be cashed in at the school store, but my daughter didn't see anything worth buying. My son has always been the kind of kid who could sell ice to an Eskimo, so they combined my daughter's ability to get a lot of Jesus dollars and my son's car salesman skills to sell their fake money for real money during recess. They had 44 real dollars when I found their stash. We don't pay for regular chores, so finding that much money in their closet at that age was a little weird. They admitted to it right away and thought their plan was great, but I did put an end to it because I didn't want parents to call the school complaining that my kids scammed them out of their snack money. I'm not religious, but it also seemed anti-Jesus-like to encourage it. My kids are teenagers now, but they keep their rooms clean and have been in charge of their own laundry for years, so their Jesus dollars operation remains the most shocking discovery, and I hope to keep it that way. Poopy school shorts. The child in question is 7, and didn't want to tell me because he had been too busy playing at home to go to the toilet. The toilet connected to his bedroom, so hid his school shorts between his desk and drawers. Gross man. When my son was 13, I found the nice button-up shirt he swore he lost balled up in the back of his closet. It was covered completely in a white substance and was very stiff. I realized what it was and never said anything. Fast forward 5 years. When my son was 18, I was cleaning up his bathroom. I was cleaning out the linen cabinet and saw what looked like a can of beer on the top shelf of the cabinet. I reached up to get it and pour it out, thinking he was hiding booze from me. I wanted to get a better look, so I grabbed it and pulled it down. As I did, liquid came oozing down my arm. I thought, what the heck? Upon closer inspection, the writing on the side said pee in a can. The smell of the liquid that went down my arm made me retch as the smell was unbearable. He had tried the half-butt attempt of washing it out, but being a young man just ran it under the sink without really washing it. I did confront my son about this find, at which point he fell down from hysterical laughter. I died a little inside that day, but I learned an important lesson. He has 2 younger brothers now going through puberty. I will not go in their room, and I always announce myself well before I ever get to their door. I make sure to be very loud going up the stairs and call for them before I ever get to the top. And that day, a lesson was learned. My mum found my contraceptive pill at one point. Never said anything about it, but I got home and she's tidied my room and left it nicely on my bedside table. Figure she was just pleased I was being sensible. My mom stacked up my pile of dirty drawings she found and put them in my binder nicely for me when I was gone visiting my dad, and she decided to clean my room. My kids' friends all hang out at my house to use my computer. Although my kids are younger, their older friend is 14. I found that he has been using my computer to look at pee, which is like a big deal. his younger brothers came to tattle on him to me and I was like, do you seriously think I didn't know? They now think I'm a computer god. My mum's worst finds were when she used to read my Facebook messages, rather than go through my room. She found messages where I admitted to a friend that I was worried I might be pregnant, read all the fights I had with my boyfriend, as I never held a relationship for very long. All the messages to my friend about feeling like I had no privacy and my friend insulting her and me not defending her. My friend still hates her. This was after I changed my password. As a child who had a very nosy parent, please just ask your kids about what is bothering them. To this day I can't have an open conversation with my mum because I don't trust her anymore. I can't tell you how much I keep from my parents because of their snooping and interrogating. It's ironic. My mom had a habit of sending me to my room as a child instead of addressing my problem behavior. Depending on her mood, I could be in there for 10 minutes or 2 plus hours. On one particular day I either had particularly egregious behavior or she was in a really bad mood. Because I got sent to my room and waited for what felt like an eternity, I started to have to use the bathroom and asked for a reprieve, and was rebuffed. So I did what any other 8-year girl would do. I decided to empty the margarine tub that held my pushpins and pee in that. It was such a novelty that I proceeded to hoard margarine tubs and things of similar size and use them as toilets for the next few weeks. I'd close the lids and carefully stack them in my desk drawer. And then one day my mom decided to clean my room. I heard the yell from a floor away and I knew the jig was up. I was horrified and scared as a child, but as a full-grown adult I can't help giggling to myself every time I picture my mom opening that drawer and investigating what the mysterious items in the tubs were. She kinda brought that one on herself. The child of the story. But my parents have two houses, one main one, and a little beach place. I maintain a room in both. My fiancé and I use an ammo can for storing our sex toys, rope, vibrators, lubes, etc. Last take we were at the beach house, it got left behind. This time when we went there, it was where we left it, but opened. If you don't know how to close it, and you're nervous due to the nature of what you found, it can be hard to close. So, one of my parents, assumably my mom, found the rope, vibrators, butt plugs, etc. Either that or the housekeeper was snooping, and I doubt that. I actually found some crazy stuff of my dad's when I was snooping around as a kid, including a gun. I live in the UK. Guns are most definitely illegal here. And huge plastic bag full of cash in the laundry basket. Turned out he was away on business a lot for a reason. WTF, your dad is badass, he's like James Bond. My mom found my wife and I's strap-on when she was letting our dogs out to potty one day. Their kennels are in our room. All I can say is, thank God she didn't find the weed. Seems like most parents found weed or the kid was thankful they didn't. My mum was helping me pack up my house after my husband died earlier this year. I had told her I'd handle our bedroom, but she went in there anyway and opened all the drawers. She found sex toys, lots of lube, boxes of condoms from when hubby and I first started dating, all my lingerie, photos of me in said lingerie. I don't know what she expected, but maybe don't open your 30-year daughter and her husband's personal drawers. I just about had a heart attack. Thank God she didn't snoop much further because we had some coke and Valium in the back of that drawer. I'm sure she would have freaked if she found it. You'd think that after something like that, she'd have the decency to leave your most intimate room to handle by yourself. I mean, it's what I'd want if that ever happens. Sorry to hear that. I hope you're doing better. I'm not the parent, but when my aunt and her family was moving out of her house about 2 years ago, all my cousins and I had gone to help and her son found $2,000 in his old closet. I think I'm missing the messed up part here. Oh, almost forgot. On the opposite end of the spectrum, my dad asked me to take his handgun to the gunsmith for repair. It's an old German weapon from World War II. I was digging in his nightstand drawers where it was, but opened the wrong drawer first. Instead, I found their special drawer. What has been seen cannot be unseen. While at a friend's house, I found his mom's dildo and gun in the same drawer. Throw away for reasons. Cleaning teenage son's room one day, using the broom to reach down and sweep under his bed. The broom clunks up against something hard in the back middle area under the bed. I'm a dust freak. Hardwood floors. So I use the broom and push the object out from under the bed so I can get all the dust. I walk over to the other side to see what in the heck it is. Before my eyes lay the absolute most massive, blackest butt dildo I have ever seen in my dang life. I said to myself, good lord, son, enjoy. But, ouch, pushed it back under and never said a word about it. Dear God. I discovered my 12-year-old had been cutting herself, found a couple instruments that she was using to cut herself, and a blood-stained towel to dab at the blood. I hadn't been intending to snoop, found it accidentally when grabbing a shirt to check size. I confronted her, and got her into counseling. Initially, she was extremely resistant, refused to get out of the car, but eventually did go in. Admitted later that it was good for her. She's almost 6 months cut-free now. I've told this story before, but a year or two ago I slowly started cleaning my son's room. He was 13 at the time, I believe. I wanted to see how long I could do this until he noticed his room was magically getting cleaner. I would go in his room when he wasn't home and tidy the bookshelf one day. Another day I would go through the box that had his old schoolwork, etc. I knew I was opening myself to finding something I didn't want to find, and I was relieved and amused that all I found was candy wrappers. So many candy wrappers. We should own stock in Hershey. My nosy mother doesn't snoop through our things usually, but one time she happened to snoop through my brother's bedroom. She found condoms. At the time, my brother has been dating his ex for about a year. My mom assumed they obviously had sex. I know this post is about the bedroom, but my parents are always managing their refrigerators around our house. One time, my mother found a bunch of empty Mike's Hard Lemonade bottles in the basement fridge. My mom assumed it was my dad at first, and then my mom said, "This is why your dad got a DUI once actually. It was my brother, and my brother had to end up admitting that he himself did it. My brother left those empty alcohol bottles in the fridge, because he could not sneak it to the recycling bin while my parents were sitting on the couch or doing whatever in the house." While organizing my 1-year-old's closet, an envelope with a $100 bill fell down. Seeing as we just bought the house, I'm guessing it was left over from the previous owners and that my infant does not in fact have a side hustle going on. When I left for college, I took all but 3 tote buckets of stuff with me. It's been 5 years and my mom decided to go through them. She found a fancy jewelry bag and opened it, expecting to find some jewelry I might want. She found my first vibrator. It was awkward. My parents, unknown to them, bought me my first vibrator. I was really into weird and cookie things, and she found a Mr. Potato Head massager and bought it thinking it would fit in W my aliens and odd kitsch stuff. Turns out Mr. Potato Head was excellent at massaging more than my back. My mom found my list of sexual partners. I keep a list for personal reasons and also so I know who to call just in case I get an irregular test result, but I digress. When I was 22 and lost it, mostly because she thought that was way too many partners for a woman to have, but also because there were women on that list. She'll never know that what she found was a super old and outdated list and that her daughter is, as the kids put it, a bit of a S. A responsible S. I'm pretty sure my mom found my prescriptions I had from after having an abortion, but she never said a word about it to me. I had hidden them in my laundry hamper for 2 weeks. Near the end of the pill cycle, I came home and mom said she had thrown some of my laundry into the wash. I panicked internally and ran back to my room. The pill bottles were in the hamper, still under one layer of clothes. I'm still convinced there's no way she missed that, and I think she just chose to take it to her grave. It was 12 years ago. When I was 13, I had 3 stash, one for booze, one for money and one for weed. My mom knew about the 3, but I had no clue. One day she confronted me with the money stash. worried that I was selling drugs or stealing stuff when all it was me stashing the weekly money she gave me. She didn't believe me, but I guess she watched it and understood what it was. Thing is, I was selling weed, just not getting much money out of it, buying half and once, sell half of that and smoke for free. She admitted to me 10 years after that she knew about the two other stash and watched their supply regularly, but since I wasn't abusing and the supply were just slowly going down every weekend and not on school days, she never said anything about it. Good guy, mum. Sometimes I'll let my 2-year-old eat in the living room. One day we were cleaning under the couch and found a pile of old food. Apparently when she doesn't like something, she will put it under there when no one is looking. She actually has several stashes of different types of objects around the house, including one for toys, one for money screws, and one for just random objects. What is that first sentence? This is sort of role reversal. When I was away in college, my grandparents used to stay at my place regularly to help take care of my sick mom. My bedroom was essentially turned into a guest room for them. I didn't have anything in there that I didn't want found. That stuff was all with me at school. After my mother passed away and we were moving out, I found a very, very crusty towel wadded up in the back of the closet. When I shook it out, there was a silhouette of a naked man and woman. Complete huge hard-on and big T. And written on the towel was "for after sex". I found my grandparents' CM rag they used after fricking in my bed. One summer, I come back from college with an Altoids tin with maybe 1.15 grams of bud in it left over from whatever we bought and smoked together. I used to smoke occasionally back then, and small amounts would last me quite a while. I was at work one day when my mom texted me, "I went to take a mint from your tin, but there was something else in it." Generally, that could be an easy mistake if it was on a dresser or something. But the tin was in my backpack in my closet under a bunch of school stuff that she wouldn't care about at all. She definitely had gone through my entire backpack to see what was in there. She is totally against smoking, and told me I wasn't allowed to have it in the house. She also told me she'd give it to my dad and he would be the one to take care of the situation. When I got home, my dad pulled me aside and said, "I have 3 things to tell you. 1. Do not bring any pot in your mother's house. If she doesn't like it, I don't like it. 2. Don't drive or do anything stupid after smoking. Don't be a dumbass. And 3. Hide your reefer better, you idiot." As he handed me the Altoids tin. Kid here. My parents caught my older brother smoking pot in the house when I was 16 and he was 19, and they flipped out. My father went into a rage and went up into his room to find an ounce of weed, which of course they thought was enough to kill him, and a big old bong along with other basic paraphernalia like lighters and papers. They flipped out even harder. In the process of yelling at my brother, my father stormed into my room and shouted, "If you have anything in here, you best come clean right freaking now, stupid, stupid 16-year-old me tried to act innocent and told him I had nothing when in reality, I was sitting on several grams of MDMA, several dozen hits of acid, and a couple different pot vaporizers and a crap load of pot. My father proceeded to tear apart my room as well and busted open a cheap lockbox I everything in with a hammer. I was on parental house arrest for quiete a while after that, as well as made to do countless chores and punishments the whole time I was home. The level of trust my parents gave me was lowered significantly for the rest of my time living at home. Kind of related, I am the child in this story. 15-year-old me charging my Juul, e-cig, and jerking off to make the time go by, when all of a sudden I hear 3 knocks, which I know will be followed by the door swinging open immediately after. I rip the Juul out of the charger and throw it under my covers along with my naked body. My mom starts questioning me. I heard a crinkle. "What are you hiding now?" I know she didn't hear anything. She must have heard some music playing on my Alexa, but she felt the need to interrogate me more. "Get up and walk to the wall. You're hiding something." So it was either get sniped with my Juul, "My parents are strict and it'd be fricked," or have a stop dead in your tracks embarrassing moment. I attempted to make my mom as embarrassed as possible by telling her I am watching P and to leave my room. She thought it was a cover up. She thought I made that up so that way I could hide something. Did I mention she had the nerve to rip my covers off anyways? It ended with her going on my phone and revealing, just like I promised, Pornhub. So yay. I guess that kind of fits in this category. Why does this feel like it could be satire if you added a few emojis and used a few more colloquialisms? I was the kid in that story. I had this phase where I enjoyed loud explosion sounds, and one day realized that empty milk cartons made a loud explosion sound when I stomped on them. So whenever we'd finish a carton of milk, it'd hide the milk carton in my bottom drawer. I had around 10 cartons stacked up in there when my mum found them because she kept wondering where that foul milk stench came from. It was difficult explaining to her why I collected empty milk cartons. TLDR. Below. For context. My mother had a huge falling out with my aunt and grandma, big enough that she cut off all contact. Even though grandma has been in and out of hospital, we aren't allowed to visit. She gets angry if we even mention them, and she made us block them on Facebook. I had been out shopping with my mum and found a pre-Owen plaque. It was a heart with a poem on it, basically saying I love you grandma. I bought it secretly and hid it on the way home, and went to the post office alone to mail it to them. They live about 4 hours away, in Bendigo. Grandma sent back a little card saying thank you and that she loved me and she was sad about the falling out, and I sticky taped it to my bookshelf so that I would see it every now and again. The left side of my bookshelf faces the door, and the right side faces the wall of my room, where you only go to access my wardrobe. Somehow, even though she hadn't been that far into my bedroom for about 10 years, my mum found it and flipped. Huh, crap, you'd think I had personally threatened her. She refused to speak to me for a week and my father came in and spent close to an hour yelling at me, telling me how awful grandma was and how he looked forward to pee on her grave. TLDR. Mum found a card from my grandma, who we weren't supposed to be talking to, and treated it like I had slapped her. If your mum didn't want you to send that to your grandma, she should have told you why she wasn't talking to your grandma anymore. If you are new to the channel, you can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Bye for now.